All set?
You're on.
All right, thank you. Welcome, everybody, to this evening's Board of Selectmen meeting. Today's February 5th. I'll go over the agenda briefly. At 7 o'clock, we have citizens' input and also any topics that haven't been, that weren't able to come up within 48 hours' notice. And also, Jeff Sienna from Meyer Insurance is going to be discussing something briefly. We'll give a chairman's update at 7:10. Attorney Frank Spillane is going to introduce a change of manager application for Waxy O'Connor's over in Main Street. At 7:30, we're going to have a discussion with Invensys, generally an update of what their plans are in the town of Foxborough. At 8 o'clock, we're going to have probably the final discussion on the potential of moving our annual town meeting to a Saturday to accommodate different types, different people. At 8:15, Kevin Pecos, our town manager, is going to present, and we're going to discuss the fiscal year 14 budget. And then 8:30, we're going to go into executive session to talk about DPW negotiation parameters. And then we have a bunch of action items in between. So, Ginny, do you want to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay. So we'll open it up to citizens' input, but could I ask if Jeff Sienna would come up first to discuss the Maya? Is Jeff in? Yeah. Actually, right at the table would be fine.
Sitting or standing?
Yeah. Whatever you're comfortable with, sitting's fine.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, just by way of introduction, Jeff is the loss control manager for the Massena Local Insurance Association. They are a wholly owned insurance company by Massachusetts cities and towns, and they are our property liability, health insurance, and workman's comp insurance company. Jeff?
Okay, thank you. Every year, the loss control team at Maya sits down and goes through all the loss records and activities of our 300 or so members. We insure cities, towns, regional school districts, water districts, fire districts, and the like. And every year we pick a small number of communities who we found have done an excellent job in controlling losses and managing the risk. This year we pick 9 towns, and we pick Foxborough as one of the ones for eastern Massachusetts of the larger communities. We did this because of the activities of your executive loss control committee. In the last year, is it year and a half, Kevin? I forget. It's a year.
2 years.
2 years. Excuse me. They have managed to get in the last year alone almost $47,000 in credits for participating in our rewards program, doing training, adopting policies, that type of things. In addition to that, there's other additional credits that the town gets, but this is specifically for their efforts in loss control and risk management. I've been managing the Maya programs for about 26 years now, and this is the only town I know of currently that does this type of job on, meeting monthly, going through everything, every loss, one by one, and trying to find out what caused it and how to prevent it. In recent memory, there's only been one other town I know has even gone to that much effort. So, this is just in recognition of the excellent job that the Executive Loss Control Committee has done, led by Kevin. And we'd like to recognize that and present you with a plaque.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you, Jeff. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. We'll get that mounted for you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, someplace prominent in here. I don't know where.
Thanks. And I'll just briefly, I know this is, when Kevin came on, it was an opportunity to look at policies, anywhere from slip and fall to insurance claims to disability. And I know you and the town hall and the folks have spent a lot of time looking at the old policies and actually implementing training, which it's come a long way in 2 years. So this represents a lot of good work from the
Thank
town
you.
And Sandra as well.
All the department heads work on that have employees, and I'll be giving them their recognition and thanks for all the contributions that they made to make that award. But they do all the work, and they really deserve all the credit for producing this great group of department heads you have.
Thank you. Okay, under citizens' input, if you would like to come up, if you're comfortable sitting at the table, if you want to go to the microphone, your choice. Thank you.
Bill Dudley, 36 North Grove Street, and I have a personal statement and then a group statement to share with you. Many weeks ago now, I revealed that I was a drive-by victim of Bill Sheehan, former teacher, recreation director, and scout leader in Foxborough. I shared my story hoping to be an encouragement to dozens of others of others whose lives were badly damaged, not allegedly, but beyond dispute, by Mr. Sheehan sexually abusing them. I came forward with the blessing of Chief O'Leary, whose concern has been the healing of the survivors of Bill Sheehan, hoping to help those who had suffered. The situation rapidly became much more complicated than we ever anticipated. Many questions unanswered haunt not only the survivors of Sheehan, but the soul of the town of Foxborough. How was one man able to commit abusive acts of atrocious nature towards so many for so long? The names and reputations of many I personally respect, past and present, are clouded by honest questions of who knew, if anyone, of these events. The heart cry of every citizen, of every victim of abuse, is why was I not protected? Was I not valued enough to be noticed and the abuse stopped? The survivors of Bill Sheehan, men and women over 30 currently known and probably dozens more unknown, deserve to have their questions answered so they may have closure. Foxborough must purge our soul of this terrible chapter in our history and make our message crystal clear. Children are loved and valued in Foxborough, and we will spare no effort to protect them today, tomorrow, forever. The more we proclaim that message, the more we protect our children, their future, our reputation, and even our pocketbooks. The survivors of Sheehan are not alone in the goal of protecting children. An example has been set for all of us by the best-known citizen in our town, town historian Jack Othellette, who recently learned that the law now made possible his protection from 67 years of harassment by his abuser, named in court documents as Bob Dow. In response to Mr. Othellette's presentation of the facts, to which I am a witness, of incidents as recent as December 2012, an order was issued by Rentham Court Judge Kathleen Campbell for his protection. Jack Othellette would gladly have that order protect every child in Foxborough rather than himself, if he could. This is why he publicly named Bob Dow, to make parents aware. Every survivor of Bill Sheehan I have been blessed to meet has the same goal: give us answers and justice, and use what happened to us to protect the children in our community today. May God help us do that. From the survivors of Bill Sheehan, I read the following. Members of the board, today the survivors, together with their families, have the same concerns expressed in the fall of 2012. The concerns are as follows: the truth about what proceeded, occurred, and ensued in the Bill Sheehan era. We have questions that surround the circumstances that allowed innocent children to be attacked and the parents' trust to be abused by a pedophile town employee. We have questions regarding any ensuing actions by his managers regarding discovery. Where are his records? Has anyone looked for them? Who is in charge of these records? We need to have the knowledge that the town has used every means to provide a clear picture of the past to present, to assist with the closure and healing for the now adult survivors and their families. This can only be accomplished by transparency on the part of the town, past to present. What safety plan is in place today to provide protection from abuse for future generations and to provide peace of mind to parents? What practices are in place for providing mandatory and ongoing child abuse prevention training to all town employees and volunteers, to include town boards, organized sports activities, and any other town-sponsored activities? As a group, we appreciate all the work that has been done to date by local police, district attorney, school department, and others to search for the truths surrounding the past failures. There is still some concern among survivors whether or not the town shares our need to uncover the truth. More information is needed. As mentioned at a previous Selectmen's meeting, we asked the town to bring in an outside agent or agency to conduct a true, uncompromised, unbiased investigation. There should be no appearance of mistrust, bias, or compromise. There are currently officers and their relatives that were involved with the Boy Scout Troop 70 during the time period in question, placing them in a potentially uncomfortable situation when questioned by their peers. In the past, specifically 1998 to 2001, with regards to police and DA involvement, there have been some inconsistencies in communication, both verbal and written. These inconsistencies may all be explainable by the town, but an uninvolved agent should conduct a separate investigation. Given tight budgets and lack of resources, there is little chance, regardless of the best intentions, that we can expect a complete airing of this chapter that will satisfy any presently unanswered questions. At a minimum, this independent investigator should be allowed to carry out the following. Number one, all survivors should be re-interviewed, as now it is more of an answer-finding mission than done initially, which was a criminal investigation. This may produce other related information. Number two, the person with the missing school file should return it. Number three, all communication at or around 2001 between local police and the DA's office must be produced. Number four, all persons on the list given by survivors to the police, where applicable, as well as any new names that come to light, must be interviewed as to any recollections, others' involvements, etc., which might help put the puzzle together. Number five, regarding the Recreation Department, all relevant files, including Sheehan evaluations, concerns, and reasons for his leaving, should be investigated. In conclusion, we, the survivors and their families, are asking the present Board of Selectmen to direct an independent person or entity to resolve these questions. The selected investigator must be given clear goals, parameters, and a time frame to answer the questions of the past, present, and future. Let's be proactive in doing the right thing. We need to make it known that the town of Foxborough is a place where kids are vigilantly protected, where pedophiles cannot succeed and will be exposed and prosecuted. Thank you for this chance to appeal to you, the survivors of Bill Sheehan. Mr. Chairman, there are two other survivors who have personal statements they'd also like to share.
Please do. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Dave Lutkus. I was here last month to thank you for your position about finding the evidence or whatever. I do have a prepared statement. It's pretty much the same as his. I do have one question I would like to ask. I did read an article recently that said Mr. Pecos responded to the question as said a number of people have stated that everyone knew Sheehan was a pedophile and that something should have been done about it long ago. I'm sorry, but that's not the case. You can say officials knew, the town knew, you know, but there's a difference in suspecting and being able to make prosecution. My question would be, are you saying that allegations were made and it was investigated and nothing was found, or that the allegations were made and nobody wanted to make waves? I guess I was a little confused when I read that. And the perception of impropriety up to this point seems to be compounding quickly, and we have files missing every time we look, everybody that asks. And that concerns me. I would think it would be in the town's best interest to willingly and thankfully accept outside help in getting this situation investigated. You know, I don't want to be here every month. You know, I don't want to keep beating a dead horse because people are going to get sick of hearing about it. But I do think it's time to get some legitimate answers. Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the board, for the opportunity to speak. My name is Kevin Collis. I was born in 1956 and raised in Foxborough, the fourth child of Frank and Marie Collis. I've been part of the Foxborough school system for 50 years as a student and employee. As many may know, last July I went to the school superintendent and then the police department. I informed them of the horrible sexual assaults that happened to me as a young child. I informed them that Bill Sheehan had assaulted me from the ages of 8 to 14. The assaults happened at the Lewis School, Cohasset River Park, and on Boy Scout campouts throughout Foxborough. Before I tell my story, I'd like to make a statement about the atmosphere and attitudes which make it so hard for victims to come forward. First, a study released just last week shows that judges in 50 states are giving less and less jail time and even lobbying for less jail time for pedophilia. They're calling all judges, wherever you sit, to give the maximum sentence to these monsters. Second, our sex offender registry is broken. Recent child abuse cases have proven that 2/3 of all level one sex abusers have abused children. Level one means less likely to offend. I call on all lawmakers to make all child abusers level three. No questions asked. These people will reoffend. Period. Third, I fail to understand why, after all we know of the harm done by these monsters, we still put on a pedestal the entertainers that joke about pedophilia. Two glaring examples are, one, Seth MacFarlane, who was one of Barbara Walters' 10 most influential people of 2012, and is host of the Academy Awards. He has a running joke on his Family Guy show about a chire boozer down the street. Quite simply, it hurts. The second is Dave Letterman. He will joke about the latest sex abuse case, such as the church scandal and the Sandusky case at Penn State. And then he is given a Kennedy Center Award and goes to the White House. Something is wrong here. We must all be more sensitive. We must take child sex abuse with more understanding of how harmful it is to the victims and their families. Now let me return to my story. I then interviewed with Detective Tom Corain, who's here tonight. I gave him details of the attacks, and I knew that at least one other victim, and I was sure there were more. He then informed me of the 98 investigation, and my name was on an A list to call. I never got that call. Being that I called the Florida DSS in 1992 to warn about Bill Sheehan, and I was told he had been accused by two boys in Fort Myers, and they stripped him of his teacher certification, and was banned from Boy Scouts. If I had received that call,
we would not be here today. And Bill Shan would be in prison hospital. Excuse me.
Kevin, do you want to sit down? It might be a little easier.
No, I'm fine.
Okay.
Do you want us to stand with you?
Yeah.
It'd be fine.
Let's go.
Stand beside him.
You want a friendship, buddy?
No, I'll do it.
You sure?
Yes.
You can do it.
I sang today before I started all day long. It seems silly, but it's Alice Cooper. Hello, hurrah. Let the show begin. I'm ready. So we're going to do it.
Finish.
Whew. Okay.
Deep breath.
I'd like to make clear that my story is one of 28 and most likely many more. Our public persona hides decades of sex abuse, of substance abuse, depression, anxiety, trust and anger issues, jail time, broken marriages, and the financial impact of all of the above. All of this has happened. I'm sorry. All of this has hampered some of us in both our careers and personal lives. I also truly believe that some of my childhood friends who have died in tragic circumstances may possibly been a result of these horrific acts by Bill Sheehan. I first met Bill Sheehan in the summer of my second grade at Lakeview Swimming Hole. I had to repeat second grade because of eye problems. That year, Bill Sheehan started teaching at the Lewis School. That day was the first of many assaults. These took place in his classroom. He then befriended me at the Cookhatchet River Park, where he was a swim director. At the park, he would take you off in the woods and rape you. If you were able to get away, he would chase you down. He always seemed to come out of nowhere and attack you. There was no getting away. After a while, it was quicker and less painful to just let it happen. I have since led a life tormented by... Oh, I'm sorry.
It's important to say.
He then would go to your house and tell your parents you could skip Cub Scouts and go straight to Boy Scouts. That was the start of the worst 3 years of my life. He did things to me that left me tormented and confused to this day. Oh, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Do you want a chair?
No.
Right.
Did I say that?
You're right.
I am right. Right? Okay. I have since led a life tormented by my past, trying to forget the horror of my childhood. I started drug use by ninth grade. My anger, then out of control, all come down on Dad. My hard drug use lasted until I married at the age of 20. Terry was someone I could love and trust. After years of not trusting anyone to get close to me, the problem was my strange ways. After 25 years, my marriage failed. She still supports me, and she's here now. She's a great mom and friend. I am blessed to have my son, Brendan, my mom, and all my friends and family here to support me. Superintendent Spinelli helped me to bring this to light of day. And along with my extended family at work have been a great source of support. This is how victims survive. I could go on all night with details, but that is just too painful. Let me just say that the results of Bill Sheehan's attacks have a lifelong impact on victims' lives. Multiply my story by at least 28, and that is what the board should understand. Hundreds of assaults on young children under the nose of those town administrators. No one knows seems preposterous. In conclusion, we would like the board to take ownership, as they are the present board responsible for the past. We are now calling on the board to make haste and implement the recommendations of my fellow victims and friends. Last but not least, please understand the financial costs of mental health service, substance abuse, and a life full of career and personal problems, all traced to Bill Sheehan, the town administration, that at the very least turned a blind eye, to the safety of a whole generation of innocent young children. Please, anybody with information, both victims and anyone else with information, to come forward. Without fear of exposure or recrimination, please call Foxborough Police or me, Kevin Collis, at 508-404-8997, or Reverend Bill Dudley. We are here to help. Please come forward with all the information you can. These were the cards I was dealt as a child in Foxborough. I have now showed my hand, and the town should show theirs. Thank you, in the spirit of truth and forgiveness. Good night.
Thank you.
One more, if you don't sure, mind. Sure, absolutely, Dan.
I wasn't going to speak tonight, and I can't leave these guys alone. I can't leave them behind. In the service, we were taught no soldier left behind. The same rule applies here. I can't leave these people, and I can't sit here and not say something. In 98, when I came forward and asked for an answer, and asked for a solution. I asked for justice for all of us and was never given that justice. In 2001, if what we've been told is correct, the investigation should have been reopened. This man should have been in jail, exactly like everybody else has said. But for some reason, it disappeared. And 14 years of my life have gone by, 14 years of worrying about being exposed in some way that's negative. I can't even explain it to you. You can't explain it to your survivor or something like this. And what I'm asking the town is for an explanation, a clear explanation, as to what happened in 01. Something happened. I've spoken to the assistant district attorney as recently as Friday, Michelle Armour, and I've spoken to Timmy O'Leary and Tom Corrane, and I've spoken to everybody every step of the way. And we're owed an answer. We are definitely owed an answer. And my fear is what the answer will be is the Board of Selectmen will sit here and say the request was brought to us. And what will actually happen is your hands will be tied. The district attorney, they'll say the case is closed. The person responsible for the crimes is not able to stand trial. But what I'm asking the Board of Selectmen to do is go beyond that and look into the other things that went on and all the hints and the allegations, the rumors that I heard Sunday. I mean, these rumors. Why did Bill Shan leave town? Was it as simple? Will somebody step forward? Will somebody have the ability, the courage to step forward and tell the truth? The whole truth, nothing but the truth. We're owed the truth. We did the right thing. We did the right thing every step of the way. And we need you to do the right thing, and the right thing by us, by the 28. And if Bill Shan was truly the rumors of him being beaten and sent away and all the rest of the things that we've heard is true, people need to understand that they beat him and sent him to Florida to have this happen again, to have children in Florida be molested. I've been told that there are three that have come forward in Florida, and that's the legacy of sending your problem down the line, of moving your problem along. I've read that Bill Shan was a teacher for 18 years and taught in 5 schools. Something doesn't make sense with that. I mean, is that normal? Do most teachers get moved 5 times in an 18-year career? Something is missing here. And that's all I have to say, is I just want an answer.
Okay. Thank you, Dan and David and Bill and Kevin. Usually on citizens' input, there's not a lot of dialogue because of the open meeting laws, but if I can speak for the board, if no one has an objection. Mark and I spent considerable time with the victims in working through this. And when I say considerable time, I don't mean in a bad way that it's too much time. It warrants the time that we've spent. A couple things that bothers me from, you know, this. And someone said it at the beginning, this isn't a matter of if it happened. There's no doubt in my mind that it did happen. I've read the stuff that came in from Florida, and I've talked to enough people, and there's a common thread of a very systematic story that's coming across. A couple things that bother me, obviously, the act itself over the number of years and the number of kids, it turns my stomach. Second thing that bothers me is if people at that time trying not to embarrass the town or embarrass their friends let it go. And in the result, this is what we get, an incredible misstep years ago. I think this board should and will lead from the front on this. I'm happy that Chief O'Leary has somebody that's going to be working, Detective Corinne, full-time on it. I spoke to him about setting up a second executive session specifically to talk about the information that's come in from the district attorney, the information that the police may or may not have uncovered. And I think at this point, if there's enough speculation, and someone had said it, there were police in the scouts at the time, and if they're still around, just the fact that they're it raises eyebrows, not to take anything away from the police or their ability to do the research, but if we take something out of their hands with an outside consultant, whether it be an investigator or the outside police, we will find the money to figure that out. I think Bill said it the other day, you know, that someone thought that the selectmen were setting all you guys up for a big failure, and I've heard the opposite, that people are coming in it for the money. So, you know, there's enough things that going around that the time that I've spent with you guys, there's no doubt in my mind that I think the right thing to do is to go forward and see what the outcome is as strong as we can and as fast as we can. The next step is going to have to be a little bit of an executive session because it's about an investigation, and I don't think it's good to throw all that information out too soon. But as much as I can help it, the selectmen will lead from the front and do as much as we can to help the victims out. And I can't imagine how incredibly that hard hard. You all have families, and to stand up and Kevin, I've known you for a few years now. I couldn't do that what you just did. It's incredibly difficult, and the emotions that must go through your guys' heads while you're trying to do it. I commend you. I'll ask if you have a little bit of faith that this board of five people will direct a town manager in the town to figure out the resources and get to the bottom of it, because I don't want to walk away from this table looking over my shoulder. Just like the reports I read from Florida, identical to what I'm hearing happened here in Foxborough. And you know, it's a shame that this guy's mental capacity, you won't get the satisfaction to see him suffer from the consequences. And we said it at the after the last meeting, we implemented a policy where if somebody in town that works for the town, whether it's a school or the town hall or the rec board or the human services, sees something, there's going to be swift action, and there's no retribution for reporting somebody. There's no gray areas. It's implemented now. The big thing is to make it continue year after year and keep the training, and I think that's the direction that we're all going in. It's unfortunate that it's too late, but I don't see a choice of getting to the bottom of it one way or the other. So if you just have a little patience, February 26th, we already have it on the agenda for executive session. If we can do it earlier, once Chief O'Leary's talks to the assistant district attorney and gets that information together, if it happens on a Monday, we'll have the meeting on a Tuesday, you know, so.
Can I make one comment?
Sure.
I don't believe anybody wants to see Bill Sheehan suffer. I think there's been more than enough suffering over the last 30 or 40 years. Mm-hmm. From what I understand is, back at the time, defamation of character was a huge problem, concern, however you want to word it. It's really looking like somebody gave him an ultimatum. I think that's who I'm looking for. Who suggested get out of town before you get in trouble? You know, Jimmy Anderson wrote an article about the Boy Scouts investigating him as a scout master and what they went through. I can't find anybody that was interviewed. I don't know if you guys have more information, less information, any information about that. But as far as him suffering, he's in his own world to hurt with the Alzheimer's. That's plenty for me. But I would like to know who pushed him down the road.
Yeah. And I think that was explained to me is what do you tell the people today? How did we let that happen? And I think that's what we've got to figure out.
But it was a different world back then. It happened with the priests and whatnot. They were all pushed. I mean, that was the way things happened. Get it out of the town.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, that's personally what I want to know. Is who made that suggestion? Who gave them the ultimatum?
Okay. All right. Thanks, David. Okay. All right. You know, we can. Is there anyone that else that wants to talk on that topic? Okay. I know there's other people to talk about some other topics. So let's do this. Let's take a 5-minute break, and then we'll come back after that. Thank you, everybody, and welcome back to the February 5th Selectmen's meeting. We're still under citizens' input. We just took a short recess. Is there anyone else that wanted to speak under citizens' input? Okay. Seeing none. Under Chairman's update, I'll be very brief. Just a couple things. We'd like to keep people informed of what we're doing in the next couple meetings. February 26th is our next meeting. We're going to be talking about the Strong Town Managers Act. We have a panel of people coming in to answer questions, and maybe we can either tweak it, reevaluate it, or at the very least better understand the Strong Town Managers Act as it relates to Foxborough. We have the Mass Gaming Commission coming in at our request for half an hour to answer questions regarding the Plainville development. We've got the New England Revolution coming in for the schedule and permit, and we've got three concerts that we made conditional approval on that we're going to close a loop on that. And we've got that executive session scheduled for the topic that we just talked about under citizens' input, and then some other budget and warrant stuff. In March, as you know, I've been meeting with the craft organization, and one of the topics that I brought up to them is if they'd entertain coming to a selectmen's meeting and just talk in general terms of what their plans are for the future, what development opportunities that they're pursuing, and have it a general question and answer for any topic that the citizens might have. And the reason I did that is because over the past we've kind of piecemealed different development discussions up there with the different boards, and we thought it was a good opportunity. If they wanted to bring up a topic, they'd get some response. If we wanted to bring up a topic of the past or the future or the current, they're kind of the seat of the pants answer it. And that dialogue, I think, would go a long way in better understanding each other. So that's going to be scheduled in March. And one of my more favorite days in Foxborough, the Founders Day is set now, so it's June 28th. So if you're interested...
No.
June 8th.
It's got to be the 8th. It's got to be...
It's usually the weekend.
It's the closest to the 10th.
June 10th.
So it's going to be June 8th.
Is it June 8th? Okay, June 8th. I wrote down the 28th. What's the 28th?
Unless they've...
Friday.
The week before.
All right, so it's not on Friday.
Yeah, the 8th is a Saturday.
Let's rewind that.
I believe it will be
on Friday.
This is the 25th year that the Founders Day has run, believe it or not. So it's a good opportunity if you want to put a float in there, if you want to make a donation, stop by. Cindy Haddad over at Cindy Haddad's Jewelry is going to be doing the chairmanship. So if you want to reach in your pocket and buy a bracelet while you're there too, I'm sure that would help her. But I think it'll be a great day, and especially 25 years running is fantastic. So,
now, Jim, is that 25 years just for Founders Day? Before that it was?
Fireman's Field Day, yeah.
The townies remember that.
That's right.
Fireman's Field Day.
Mm-hmm. That went on for, since you were a child, right?
Yes. Yes. Nice. And I'm not that old. So there you go.
I've learned not even to go in that direction.
Yeah, so, please.
Okay, we're a little behind, but is Frank Spillane in the room? Do you want to come up, Frank? And we've got a change of manager's application for Waxies. Packet, you should have the ABCC applications and resume and everything. Welcome. And if you could just introduce yourself for the record.
Attorney Frank Splane for Waxies Mass LLC, and with me is Joseph Wiltrups, who is applying for the manager's position on the liquor license.
Do you want to present anything, or ask if we have any questions from the application?
I think the application has everything with regard to his employment status. Okay. I think, as the board knows, the former manager, Omina Dragonhide, has moved on. Mm-hmm. He's no longer with the facility in any capacity. So we need to change the manager's name on the license.
Okay.
Joe's had an extensive... resume on with regard to restaurants. Joe, why don't you just give them a brief overview of your employment?
I grew up in Stoughton, so Town Spa was the big thing for us. The pizza, you can call for 30 or 2, it's always 20 minutes. All the people that work there, if you go in there now, the waitresses probably 40 to 50. And all the kitchen help are all people from the town. So it's been a pretty successful model. I kind of like that, the community. They sponsored all the teams and everything. Trips to Atlantic City, was young and old. So that was kind of how I grew up. And then I just kind of started working in the restaurant industry during school. I've been in some pretty good places, Cheesecake Factory, obviously the corporate training that they have. As far as getting everyone up to speed, testing you on your food knowledge, even the schedule of time to get to the table, professionalism, if there's a problem, bringing a manager out. I did 5 years at the Sunset Grill and Tap in Boston. It's one of the largest beer selections in the world. This guy was a really good owner as far as the training. I started as a bar back. I did that for 9 months. Wanted to go on the bar, so he made me first expedite and run food, and you had to become a waiter. Then you became a bartender, and then you became a manager. So kind of learned from some good people as far as how you have to learn, each facet of the restaurant industry to go forward. All that being said, just comes down to customer service, thanking people, trying to get the repeat business, and taking the customer's input, and just being aware of what's going on, trying to be a value to the community. Mm-hmm. That's it.
Any questions from the board?
We've seen you before, Joe. You know, you've been here a couple of weeks ago, correct?
Yes.
It says 40 to 50 hours that you'll be there. And so do you have, like, new ideas that you're working with the marketing firm?
Since that day.
Yeah.
Should be pretty good on Friday. We brought in another chef. I think we have 15 new menu items. One of the things that we did is we took the last 6 months and started really looking at what was in, what wasn't. So we weren't just picking new ideas. We were actually eliminating things that weren't selling. We started looking at all the different restaurants in the area. What do they have? What can we offer that they don't? Things like our patio. Obviously, we do entertainment where Patriot Place doesn't. I mean, Toby Keith's, that's country and whatnot.
Could you just move that microphone over a little bit?
But it's really been about the food, the training, customer service, appointing where we brought a new chef in. He's in charge of the kitchen. Now we have a new bar manager. We have a shift leader as far as the wait staff goes, and then myself. Where before was everyone was just kind of fending for themselves.
Right.
So we have a pretty good management structure in place. Even changing a bunch of our drink selections. We have a pretty good idea of everything that we've done. The stuff that we did with you guys for the hearing was just to ensure that we were following everything that we had to do to make sure that we didn't have any alcohol-related problems. And now the focus has strictly been on how can we be a value to the community, how can we make Waxies represent and make some money for the employees. So, we didn't want to shut down, but it's been a good time for us to actually sit back and start new. So we're kind of excited for Friday.
So you've taken advantage of that
and
training and
absolutely everything.
Getting used to your new systems. And
all the way down to thinking our Diet Coke is flat. I mean,
we don't want that to happen.
Nope.
Yet. No,
but
that
I'm saying
can't happen.
We literally started with Mark, who was here, and Paul,
mm-hmm.
walking in the front door. And from here, what do you see? What's the experience all the way to the back of the kitchen? So, yeah.
Good.
I'm pretty good.
Any other questions?
No, but just from your work experience, you were there during the troubles, if I may say. So you know what can go wrong.
I do.
And it makes me feel better that you know what went wrong and you know what's expected of you. So I wish you all the luck, and I think it sounds like it's going to be very successful.
Thanks.
And I'm very happy for you.
Thank you.
So I want to wish you good luck.
Thanks.
Good luck.
Thank you.
I have a comment similar to Lorraine's. I won't be as nice. I mean, Lorraine, I keep doing that. Jenny, sorry. You were an assistant manager and a bartender since 2009 at Waxies, right? That's what's on your application here?
At Waxies?
Am I reading this wrong? This right here?
Assistant manager was recent, so yes.
Is it 2009?
Oh, that's just my tenure, the 2009 when I started. I started 2 weeks before St. Patrick's Day. I was an assistant manager at that point. What?
You started as a bartender.
I started as a bartender. I thought you were asking if I was a manager at that time. That was the date that I started.
I'm reading it. Bartender, assistant manager, March 2009 to present at Waxy O'Connor's.
You started as a bartender.
Yeah.
Yep.
Moved to assistant manager. Okay. I got involved in this in 2010, and I sat, and I'll be frank with you, I voted against giving you the license back.
Yep.
So on the tolerance, I'm below a zero from
right.
a scale of zero, 1 to 10. I do wish you luck and success, but when I sat here and people came up and said, you know, they're finding out this for the first time, the surprise, they came in from Florida, I'm not sympathetic to that because you
yep.
lived through it since 2009.
Yep. I agree.
The people that came in, that flew in, were here before. So I don't want to rehash things, but if this comes back again, I'm going to fight as hard as I can to shut it down, and I'll be as blunt as I can.
I think we realized that from the last hearing that this is our last chance, so we don't really look at this as we'd be standing trying to prove our case again. I mean, if something happens,
and I don't want to go back and do
end.
That, but
yeah.
the fact that you were a bartender through that whole time and working it, I don't want to lose fact that you were
right.
in the trenches during that whole time,
and you know,
you're not starting fresh from here. You've got
right.
those 3 years.
Well, the one thing that I will say without, I actually thought about calling Mark, and although Mr. Hyde mm-hmm. was the problem, my own self-analysis, I got to a point, well, the ownership has to be responsible too. I think what happened is when we opened, the numbers were great.
Mm-hmm.
Mark would come up, take a look at, Gordon's on his best behavior. Whole restaurant is full. Things look great. You spend a week here. You go back. I think that went on for a little bit. I think that's how it happened. But, I was against a lot. But just trying to make money, living a mile away, it was pretty good. But, we recognize this is pretty much it for us.
Yeah. Okay.
So.
Very good. Thank you. Okay,
so
any more discussion? Make a movement.
I move that we accept the application to change the manager to Joseph Lefrup for Waxy O'Connor's. Mm-hmm.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. Best of luck.
Thanks. Thank you. Good luck, Joe.
Thank you. Hope to see you there.
Okay. I feel welcome now.
Is this Vince still here?
Well, we're going to cut their time to 5 minutes now to catch up.
Yeah. Welcome. Are you Steve?
I'm Steve Sacco,
okay.
Yes.
Nice to meet you. Thank you for coming. If you want to just introduce yourself for the record, and also I know you have some guests with you as well. Maybe
sure.
You want to introduce them.
So first of all, I'd like to thank the board and the town manager for allowing us to come and meet with you tonight. I'd also like to acknowledge that we have State Rep Jay Barrows in the audience, as well as some members of the Tri-Town Chamber of Commerce. And as you mentioned, my name's Steve Sacco. I'm Senior Vice President with Invensys. I'm based here in Foxborough, although I do live in Mansfield.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been with the company here for about 10 years. And my role is I look after global real estate. And for us, we have more than 250 locations in 50 countries that I'm responsible for. And with me tonight, I have Lynn Tokarczyk. She's a government incentives consultant, and she's providing the company with some advice on tax incentives.
Okay.
And I also...
I'm sorry?
Did you want us to continue? Or?
Oh, sure. No,
oh, okay.
Absolutely.
I didn't know if you wanted to...
Oh, no.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
The floor is yours.
And I also have Steve Altieri with us, who's part of our Human Resource Department. He's our Director of Human Resources, also based in Foxborough here.
Okay, great. Okay, and I know you met with Mark recently and discussed different thoughts of staying in Foxborough or investing in Foxborough. So if you want to just talk about what's on your mind.
And Mark suggested we come and meet with the board and just have an open discussion. So that's why we're here tonight.
Great.
And from our perspective, we very much enjoyed being part of Foxborough for many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to come here tonight to tell you just a little bit about the company, what some of our proposed investment plans look like, and also share with you our intention to apply for some tax incentives. And we'll try to keep it brief and be open to questions. Okay.
And can I just say, I mean, you guys have been in here for 100 years? Close to it?
101 now.
101.
102. Yeah.
It's 104, actually.
Yeah, so it's you're 90. very valued business owner in town, so take the time that you need. We're not going to rush you off.
Sure, I understand. So, and I think, like you acknowledged, the board and many of the people in the town know the company. They know it well. We've had many generations of Foxborough residents work for the town. And in fact, currently we have more than 100 Foxborough residents that are working for the company at this point. What you may not know is that we are a large company. We have facilities all over the world, and we're a global technology company. We do engineering design. We design software. We do manufacturing for a variety of industries like oil and gas, mining, pharmaceuticals, high-tech manufacturing, things like that. And basically, we write software. We do engineering, consulting, and design. And we make things like temperature gauges, sensors, pressure gauges, things like that. As you mentioned, we've been a significant employer and partner with the town for more than 100 years. And what you may not know is that our division headquarters was based here in Foxborough for that time until about 5 years ago, where it was relocated to Texas to be closer to some of our oil and gas customers. Today, we have approximately 1,000 full-time permanent employees based here in our Foxborough operations. Overall, we have about 21,000 employees globally. The average tenure of our employees in Foxborough is 21 years. I think that says a lot about the company. We've got good employees. We've had good relationships, and many people spend their whole careers here with the company. When we talk about our employees, we have a diverse set of jobs. We do everything from here in Foxborough, software engineering, mechanical and electrical engineering. We do research and development. We do high-tech manufacturing and assembly. We bring customers into Foxborough on a very regular basis. We have a training facility here. So we have a very diverse employee population with diverse sets of responsibilities. And like I said, you know, our relationship with Foxborough is something we're very proud of, and it's something that both the company and our employees have been very involved and active in. I had the honor to be here last October when, on behalf of the company, I accepted the Community Award. And I think most people realize that, you know, in the past year, we had done many activities in and around the Foxborough area with our employees. But that's something that we've done for a long, long time, for many, many years. And in fact, we're planning another set of events this coming April as part of National Volunteer Week to continue that good work. What you also may know is that both the companies and the employees contribute significantly to the local economy. And we estimate between the company and our employees, we spend approximately $6 million annually in Foxborough on everything from hotels, whether it's the Marriott, the Renaissance, the Courtyard, to restaurants like My Pearl or Asia Ginger or Mega Pizza, to other engineering services locally. And one of the reasons we're here is because we've had a very good and strong relationship with the town, and we wanted to tell you some of our thoughts and some of the things that we're considering. What we have here in Foxborough in terms of our footprint, our campus footprint, is we have three locations. We've got the location that we call Bristol Park, which is down on Route 140 across from the Shell station. And it consists of two leased office buildings where we have administrative offices and our training center. We also have a large engineering building over on Mechanic Street across from the YMCA. And that's a leased building that we do a lot of our engineering, research and development in. And then we have our Neponset building, which is takes up most of Neponset Street. And in it, we have a variety of different things, everything from high-tech manufacturing, research and development, engineering, offices. It's a very large building with a lot of different areas in it. We're approaching the lease end of two of our buildings, the buildings over in Bristol Park and the building over at Cocasset. The Neponset building is owned. And as we've been coming towards those lease ends, we've been evaluating what our real estate options are, both here in Foxborough and elsewhere. And we've started to look at facilities in the area, in Foxborough, in the I-95, 128 corridor, and elsewhere. And we've engaged real estate brokerage firms and other professional service firms to help us in that process. Our goal and what we need to do is to really provide a modern, attractive workspace for our employees. We do at present have vacant space in our buildings. It's outdated space. The Neponset building is almost 100 years old. There's a need to upgrade the space. We want to make it attractive not only to our existing employees, but also to attract new engineering talent to our company. And we also want to be able to collaborate and bring our employees together. So one of our proposed options is to stay in Foxborough and make a significant investment into the buildings, into the leased Cocasset building and the owned Neponset building. As part of that proposal, we would look to renew the lease for the Cocasset building. We would likely vacate the lease of the Bristol Park buildings and consolidate our employees together. And we would look to invest approximately $30 million over the next couple of years into those facilities. And that would be for updating, building out offices, improving the infrastructure, improving space for engineering and research and development. And this is very important for us because we are in a competitive industry and we want to maintain our leadership position. Our expectation is that if we make this significant level of investment into our real estate footprint, that our real estate taxes would rise. And so we wanted to come to the board at the beginning of our decision-making process here to give you a little bit of information, to talk a little bit about the project, to discuss our desire to apply for tax increment financings, or TIFs, under the state-run program. And my colleague Lynn here can explain a little bit about how that works. We also want to understand if the board is receptive to sitting down and having further discussions with us, and also talk about who we need to work with and how we need to have these discussions. And I think it's important that the board realize that these proposed tax incentives and this proposed project is very important to the company. It is a significant investment for any company, that amount of money. And we do operate in a very global competitive environment where we have lots of options available to us. And because we're a financially driven company, we do need to make a strong case, not only to our management locally, but our management elsewhere, that this is the right thing to do for the company. So we're hoping to initiate these discussions and have some incentives discussed and secured over the next few months so that we can take our final decision on what our plans look like. So that's what I wanted to introduce to the board. And Lynn here will talk a little bit about some of the program and maybe some of the details.
Great. Thanks, Steve. Well said.
Okay. Thank you again. And again, my name is Lynn Tokarczyk, Government Incentives Consultant for Invensys. And wanted to talk about the TIF process, timing, all of that. But before I get into that, wanted to just reiterate some of the additional economic benefits as a result of Invensys trying to make a decision in hoping that they will stay and grow here in Foxborough. So really, it's about keeping the largest manufacturer and one of the largest taxpayers here in Foxborough, renovating underutilized space and making a significant investment. And as the company considers renovating the property and continuing to grow in Foxborough, As Steve mentioned, there's, you know, there's available real estate in other communities, newer available real estate in other communities, especially during this economic climate. You know, we're still not at full economic growth, and you know, there's significant commercial vacancy rate in the region. And it's based on our research, working with our real estate advisor colleagues in the greater region, it's still it's over 20% for industrial and in office. So that's still extremely high in this area. Mansfield, however, one of your contiguous communities, has done a great job, you know, with the Cabot Business Park. So that's really not even in the mix here. So as well as the community involvement and the spend that Steve mentioned by the company and its employees, Foxborough would also maintain significant hotel and meals taxes, because whenever they have trainings and, you know, corporate suppliers, vendors are coming in, they bring entourages in. So they're always coming, staying at the hotels and spending here. Locally, and as you know about their involvement, they do think locally, so there's, again, lots of money to be spent in Foxborough. So really, Foxborough is positioned to keep a company with its deep roots in the community. So now about the, as they call it, the TIF program, which is also known as the Economic Development Incentive Program. This program was implemented back in 1993, and it's an economic development tool to retain and attract businesses. And the town of Foxborough became an economic target area back in 2003, as you recall. 2003, you're part of a regional economic target area known as an ETA. The official name is the I-495-95 South Regional Technology ETA, and that consists of 10 communities. So Foxborough's in the mix, and it's really from Mansfield all the way north to Bellingham, and then, you know, all the contiguous communities, as you are aware. And it's been a great successful tool in the region. In most of those communities, there have been approximately 18 companies that have applied for incentives, whether it's a TIF or a special tax assessment. Very successfully, and have really been drivers with growing the economy and growing jobs and keeping jobs in the region. So that was back in 2003. So kind of fast forward to 2010, there have been some significant legislative changes to the Economic Development Incentive Program. And so basically for this particular type of project, which would be known as a TIF-only project, it would specifically be known as a job retention project. So really to keep 1,000 jobs here, to retain 1,000 jobs, the company then would be applying for a TIF-only. Lots of legislative changes in the laws and different categories of different projects. You know, now communities that are non-ETAs can offer TIFs if companies meet certain criteria. Mm-hmm. So there's been a bucket full of changes, and we have all those laws that, you know, I'd be happy to share, you know, with you and forward to you. So again, so first it's an ETA within an economic target area, then EOAs need to be designated, which are really the taxable parcels that the company. So in this particular case, there were two potential projects, the larger manufacturing facility, mm-hmm. Neponset, and then the Cohasset would be the two properties that would more or less be applying for these incentives. And so from there, then the company would apply for a TIF. And just to kind of refresh, as you know, a TIF, tax increment financing, is an incremental phase-in on the new incremental taxes that are generated as a result of a project. So if there are existing buildings, the town continues to collect full taxes on that building, on the properties, and on the taxes. So the beauty about a TIF is the town doesn't lose a dime on the existing taxes. The company proposes to spend dollars to invest in renovate the buildings. Well, that's going to increase a new assessed value. So it's the new incremental assessed value, therefore the new incremental taxes that a TIF is based on. There's always a myth out there that, you know, communities will lose tax revenue. Well, if the project does not move forward, then there's a risk that there will be no new tax revenue coming in. So again, the town wouldn't lose any existing real estate tax revenue, again, for the Cohasset and the Neponset buildings. And so basically a TIF is a discount on the projected new real estate taxes, and full taxes are collected, again, as well as any new projected. And TIFs, actually, in the 18 that I mentioned, and there are many, many more, there are approximately 1,500 statewide that have been approved, you know, are used as a great economic development tool, and many of them have been very, very successful. Now, however, if companies do not meet their obligations, of course, you can imagine there's lots and lots of paperwork, applications, and the company, the town would be making some commitments. But if the company does not meet its commitments or obligations, then the town is protected within the agreement to petition to the state to have the project decertified, and tax incentives on a go-forward basis would be withdrawn. So there are definitely protections for the municipality. As you may know, with TIFs also, personal property taxes are available, could be exempt, but because Invensys is classified as a manufacturer with the Massachusetts Department of Revenue, they're exempt already. That's one of the benefits of being a manufacturer in Massachusetts, so they're exempt at the local end. So just wanted to talk a little bit about the TIF process and the timing. And, you know, we've worked with many, many TIF projects over the years in some of the contiguous communities. In Mansfield, we've worked with Samsonite Corporation, Smith & Nephew Endoscopy, many of the Medline Industries that you'll see going up. We recently worked with Horizon Beverage in Norton, Siemens Diagnostic in Walpole, so a lot of close-by communities. And I actually used to work for the Massachusetts Office of Business Development that implements this program, and then I was with Ernst & Young. And for the past 10 years, just assisting growing companies expanding here in Massachusetts. So the process and the timing, you know, here we are in February. It's kind of hard to believe where we are in the year already. And the company is hoping, in order to meet their timeline, in order to make a decision, is to submit a TIF proposal to the town next week. And then from there, working with your TIF team, we would hope to meet that week or the following week to sit down and discuss the TIF proposal, you know, why this TIF, you know, why these numbers. And so we would hope that you'd be able to establish some type of TIF team. Typically a TIF team is 2 to 4 individuals from a town. So, you know, that's up to you. So we would hope, you know, to meet sometime in February to have those discussions. Once there's a mutual arrangement between the TIF team and the company, then it would need to go to the Board of Selectmen for their recommendation of that proposed TIF to town meeting, and that timeline would be in March. And then from there, if that was a favorable recommendation, then to present it to your May town meeting. Okay. And then, of course, the state does have the final vote, which would be the end of June. And that really ties in with the company's timing. And so, you know, that's the proposed plan. And, you know, we'd be happy to answer any questions, you know, talk about your timing, who's on your TIF team, mm-hmm. and all of that. So okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Lynn. Steve. I guess we can open it up for questions and discussion. But if you don't mind, I do have some experience with TIF, and I've worked at Smith & Nephew, and I might put you on the spot, Ed, but Ed Tartufo is the president of the Tri-Town Chamber of Commerce.
Never made it to that level. My spelling was high enough.
What are you?
No, I'm just a director in the trench.
Okay.
I have been vice president of economic development.
That's what I'm thinking.
Some other titles, but.
But you were also selectman in Mansfield and worked through this process with them. Do you mind sharing some of your thoughts on this from a neighboring town perspective?
You should come up here.
Yeah.
Thank you for letting me speak, Mr. Chairman. I've been a director of the Chamber for a little over 20 years. And during that time, I've served in different capacities. And back about 10 years ago, Charlie Masterson was president of the Chamber of Commerce. And the 10 towns were trying to form this regional ETA. And Charlie said, we need a representative because each chamber was entitled to have a representative as well as each community to sit on that committee. So he encouraged me and supported me to do that since no one else wanted the job anyways. And what I've learned through that process is that, as Lynn has mentioned, there's been 18 TIFs and STAs that have come out of our 10 towns along the 495 belt. Was that there's some very keen competition today where other communities within our own state, our own neighboring communities, are trying to attract companies within our own towns to move to their communities. Not only competition from our local communities, but other states are competing for those same companies. About a year and a half ago, I had the opportunity to go to a meet and greet in Boston where there was an international economic development group from another country that was there trying to look for sites in Massachusetts where they wanted to invest. And we were there to try to convince them to come to our area. So, you know, that competition is very keen today, and they're not that far away. The largest industrial park in New England is just 15, 20 miles down the street in Taunton. And they're trying whatever they can. They've just recently opened another 200 acres in that park to attract new businesses there. So we realize that there's competition there to try to get these companies, and the difficult ones are the manufacturing ones. Because those are the higher paying jobs. Those are the ones we definitely want to keep. And they create the multiplier effect of the economic development throughout our whole area. Last year, I put together a chart of large companies from our three towns, Mansfield, Naughton, and Foxborough, and wanted to find out where their employees lived. Because I think some of our old thinking is that, well, you know, we've got Invensys and they're ours. We've got CC&F and their hours. Horizon Beverage, Cisco and Norton is another example that left the area. But it doesn't stop at the border. And what I found is out of those 1,000 employees of the Foxborough Company, there's about 600 of them that live in the surrounding abutting towns to Foxborough. So when they get their paycheck, they take it home next door. And that economic development and money they spend isn't just in Foxborough. It's survival of the other communities next door to you. And those larger businesses help the smaller businesses now become productive, and they can produce some economic benefits and results. So the spinoff is tremendous. And when we look at our areas, you know, we live in some great towns where we are right now. And we've got great school systems. We've got great towns to live in. Towns with good school systems attract good people and attract good companies. Our unemployment rates are a lot lower than the other towns throughout Massachusetts. So when you look at how they're published in the paper, you know, we're head and shoulders over those other towns. Okay, and you've got states like Rhode Island. Some of those companies want to move into Massachusetts, and they have moved to Massachusetts. And one reason they do move is because they don't have the educated workforce to come to work in a place like the Foxborough, Invensys from the Foxborough Company. Okay, we've got the educational training for them. They're within easy commuting distance to get to our towns, and easy distance to go back if they live in another bedroom community. So we've seen some changes in our area, and you know, we really have to protect our communities. And one way of protecting those communities is to assist these other businesses to flourish and to grow here. It's important to all of us. It just doesn't stop at the border. We're all got something at stake. So And as far as the TIF process, I think Lynn outlined some of that, how that starts. You've got plenty of opportunities to vet out the company, whether it's worthwhile and deserving of a TIF. You form your own advisory committee, however you want to do it, and bring in your people, usually a town manager, a finance committee, assessor, other members you think can put some value into that decision. And they negotiate with the company. And then they bring it to you with their recommendation. Mm-hmm. If their recommendation is no, then you're probably not going to recommend it at the town meeting. I would suspect with the Foxborough and Invensys have been here for so long that I would think you would work towards a positive recommendation for that. Your town meeting voters now have the decision whether they want to support that TIF. And then that is supposed to go to our regional committee, which only convenes when there's a meeting over the TIF. I think Lynn is the only consultant I know of that has actually brought it to our regional committee. There's one other that came into the Mansfield Industrial Park that did not follow that process. I suppose they could be in jeopardy of losing that TIF if they didn't follow every procedure, but who's gonna squeal? I'll do that later off mic. And then it goes off to the state level, and then the state would put their stamp on it. So I think you've got an awful lot to gain with a great company and a great reputation with great people that work there. So we're hopeful that you can go forward with this and create something that's positive and good for everyone. And thank you very much for letting me speak.
Thanks, Ed. The reason I invited you to my wedding 18 years ago. Thanks for the gift, by the way.
No, thank you, no.
I got to ask, Jay, do you want to say anything? I almost regret asking because you never say no.
A lot of Mansfield Hornets speaking that.
I know. I was going to say, Steve, don't ever apologize. You're from Mansfield, okay? You're doing great work in Foxborough. Growing up as a kid, seeing my dad work at the company, my mom work at the company, my aunts and uncles and cousins and so forth. It was never called the Foxborough Company. If you lived within 30 miles of here, it was called the company. And so for 104 years, they've celebrated a great history. Steve failed to mention the Invensys Y on Mechanic Street. Had it not been for the generosity of Invensys, we wouldn't have ended up with a Y here in Foxborough with some 8,500 or 9,000 members. It's truly, truly been amazing. And it was that with that gift and the financial support that they gave the Hockomock Y, it was the opportunity of a lifetime for the association to do that. I've seen firsthand the work that they've done in the charter school with the STEM program that's being run over at Foxborough Regional. Science, technology, engineering, and math, doing the same thing in the high schools. Their employees giving back to help our future engineers, hopefully future employees of Invensys. Tonight I speak really as the state rep for a great region of Mansfield, Foxborough, and Norton, and the spinoff that Invensys has in those communities as well. It's not just Foxborough, but it's the entire region. And as Ed mentioned, when we looked at where people are coming from to come to work, it's a pretty big circle. But the spend is here in our communities, and what I said it last week at the annual meeting at the Chamber of Commerce, is what's good for Norton is good for Foxborough and Mansfield and vice versa. It really, really helps us all, and it helps support those good schools that we're paying for. It helps support and make a great community, whether it's the athletic fields or it's the sponsorships or whatever it is that goes on in our towns. It makes us unique, and it's through the help of companies like Invensys. I think Lynn failed to mention Covidian was one that we recently did, and that was kind of a rehab situation as well, where they needed to enhance their facility. And today we have over 1,500 employees in Mansfield that are spending money here in Foxborough as well. So it does go, certainly goes both ways. So any help that I might lend, I know at the state level we've had a great batting average with anything that we've taken up from both Norton and Foxborough, of Norton and Mansfield as TIFs. We've gotten approval at the state level. In fact, I ran into somebody the other day from the Economic Development Commission. He said, where have you been? I haven't seen you around in a while. I didn't wink and say, I'll be back. But, you know, we really, really need to see more activity, and we need to keep fighting every day because there's everybody in the Commonwealth that is working hard for their communities as well, trying to attract and keep the businesses that we have. And this is really right in the strike zone, it being manufacturing, high-tech manufacturing with the technology piece associated with it. It is huge. And the work we've done, we've made all of us as taxpayers into Bristol Community College, doing some training there, students getting associate degrees. So it's all kind of wraps together, and it's important, you know, all the way around. So appreciate your consideration. And again, if there's any help that I can do in my office to assist you in any way, be happy to. So thank you.
Thank you, Jay. Appreciate it. And Kevin, can I ask you either speak independently or if you've spoken with Randy, our finance director, on your thoughts on this? Before we discuss?
Sure, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I've participated in a number of TIFs, primarily in Hingham, where we did quite a number of them in order to do economic development on the waterfront and also in an industrial park on the Rockland-Hingham-Weymouth line. They can be extraordinarily successful under the right conditions. Often the right conditions are such that you can correctly identify the economic development so-called multiplier effect that occurs from the public making an investment of forgiving tax dollars in the TIF. Because at the end of the day, what has to be explained to the voters at town meeting is why are we giving up this revenue? And so the explanation has to be for value received over here. And so that's a fairly vanilla analysis that's done. And following that analysis, if the conditions are right, typically it works very well. In this case, I'm especially optimistic, and can say that to the board, because we don't just have a partner here where I think there's clear economic benefit from that multiplier effect, but this is a rare jewel in our collective crown, I guess. I won't push that metaphor too hard. But this is one of the most extraordinary partners we have. We have two preeminent business partners in Foxborough. Lots of other smaller partners, but two very preeminent ones. And this particular business has a century of history with this community. You know, as an outsider looking at what is evident here, this is an extraordinary corporate partner whom we cannot afford to lose, this region can't afford to lose, and the Commonwealth of Mass can't afford to lose. 1,000 employees, including well over how many engineers in the technology facility?
Yeah, it would be several hundred engineers, yeah.
A concentration of several hundred engineers is an extraordinary situation in the state of Massachusetts, for any state. So this is a wonderful opportunity, and I can say to the board that without any hesitation whatsoever, this obviously merits great consideration and review. I just have one question. So is it the case that if the town of Foxborough were to, we were to come to agreement and grant this TIF, that Invensys would be staying?
I think with this kind of investment, we would be making a significant commitment to the town and to our business here locally.
Well, that's probably the best and biggest economic development news this town has had in a long, long time. So that's wonderful.
Okay, anyone else from the audience? And we'll open up for discussion at the board. Thank you, Kevin. Discussion?
Sure.
Yeah. Well, so we'll just have a round table. I won't call
just,
people.
Kevin, in your experience over in Hingham, how many people would be involved in this type of group that you would put together? Who would be the members?
Well, I put down some notes. I know our town planner, we have an extraordinary planner, much, much better resource than a lot of communities have, and I know Sharon's got some experience with it. town or special counsel, depending upon experience with TIFs, because you really need that legal expert. Randy, obviously, our CFO, and I don't know whether it would be our assessor or Hannah, our assessor, because there's some, a lot of implications in how this gets put together. And that's a pretty good core team right there.
Bill Casper, if you're talking about building expansion or building renovation?
Sure, absolutely.
Bill is our building inspector.
What about somebody with some experience like Jay Barrows or Ed?
More than welcome.
I mean, I'm not saying nobody else
more
has
than welcome.
But it just seems like Jay's got a vast of experience on this. I mean, if he's not conflicted.
I can sort of give you the core disciplines you need from the staff side of it, and then the board needs to kind of say, you know, do you want to have any other expertise or input beyond that? Sometimes what we've done is we've had sort of a two-layered approach where the technical folks, the staff, kind of put this thing together and negotiate and then present it to, you know, some other folks that you might want to have opinions from, opinion leaders in town, planning board, folks like that, and sort of give you a parallel perspective on it. So the board's got kind of two perspectives. One is, you know, from the point of view of what works in the community, and from a technical point of view, what does the staff see? And maybe you want to do something like that. Only one cautionary note is you don't want to have the TIF committee be like 14 people or something, because it just gets the QE2. We can't move the thing anywhere. You know? And their timeline is very aggressive, and that's fine. I don't see any problem with that timeline, but we all need to understand going into this that this is going to have to move quickly. This is not going to drag on. We're going to get these good folks some answers and some report back to the board, and it's going to need to move.
Sure.
It's going to be a big undertaking in a very short time. Mm-hmm. And thank you for bringing this in the middle of budget season. Very much appreciate it.
Anyone else from the board? Discussion? Mark?
Go ahead.
Well, I did a quick calculation. You see, Steve, you said $30 million in renovations and expansion. So just to put it in simplistic terms, at $7 on $1,000, it's $210,000 in building fees for permitting. And then there's other permitting on top of that. That's income to the town, unless you're looking to waive that too. It's not part of this, right?
Excuse me?
We wouldn't be looking away building permit fees.
Oh, no. No, that's not part of this program.
And then...
unless you want to offer.
No.
Darn good idea, right?
And then obviously, they'd be using local companies, I would imagine so. No matter, you know, what they consider locals from Boston, Rhode Island, to this area to take on such, a project. And that's a just the dramatic increase in the business in the center of town from the library project for the restaurants and everything has been great. And this $30 million project, you're looking at 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing is, too, is one thing some of the former speakers didn't mention is there's been a lot of great companies that have been spin-offs from being employed by your company. I know a couple of entrepreneurs that are very wealthy that used to work for your company. And they're based in Mansfield, in the Cabot's Industrial Park. So it's a lesson taught, and it keeps moving around and it expands, just like leadership. So I look forward to the discussion, and I hope we can work together. I mean, don't ask for the moon, and we won't ask for the basement, and we'll just, you know, work together on this like the relationship has always been. So.
Oh no, I think it's a good project to investigate and put the committee together and look into it. And if this turns out to be good for the town, well then. But you won't know that until the committee is formed and all the information is gathered. So, I would encourage the committee being formed and that we look at it.
Well, I'm one of those ones that Jay mentioned, generations, and so my mom worked there for 45 years, my dad worked there for 43 years, I worked there for 12 years. I still have a good relationship with you folks. So I just got a couple questions, Steve. The training center, so that's over there now. At Bristol Park, is that going to be coming over to either Neponset or that's like not going to Texas or something, right?
That's not the intention. That's part of, that would remain here in Foxborough as part of this renovation project.
Great, great. And, I mean, just, I wish we had Jack up here because we could go on and on about how the Bristol Brothers, you know, they saw a need in the town for something, whether it's we needed something to do with electric, they came right in and helped us out. And then there was even a water situation that we needed help with that, and they helped out. So, I mean, this relationship needs to stay here in Foxborough. And I think that Kevin put together the right team, that's how it's going to go, because it will always be the company to me. And others. And right now you are one of the biggest taxpayers, but the things that you give back are equal to our other taxpayer, you know. So I look forward to it. I think it's great, and I think that your employees are comfortable here and would rather come to work in Foxborough too. I know that you're a Mansfield guy now, but, you know, you do spend most of your time here in Foxborough, so so you can be a Warriors fan too, Steve. So had to throw that in, Jay.
We could convert him, Linda.
I know. It's been tried. So I look forward to that meeting that everybody's going to get together and. And I think it's great news, because I think there's some people that are out there are nervous, you know, about the situation, and that, you know, if they're gone, what's going to happen? You know, I would hate to see those buildings just end up like certain buildings in other communities that aren't, you know, kept up or worse. So I'm glad to see that the two that you're keeping are the Neponset and the Cohasset too. So.
Based in the center, I agree. Based in the center, and you know, it's very good news. I think it takes the attention off, like you said, Linda. This has been talked about for years, mm-hmm. that we're competing with Texas, and they could go to Texas, and mm-hmm. you know, just the that you bring this forward in such a straight manner, just come out and say it. This is what we want to do. You put the proposal out there. It's very easy to deal with. It's very open and sincere, and I appreciate that.
Okay, a few more items. So actually, probably by the end of this week, what's required by law is that you will be receiving an incentives intent letter mm-hmm. of the company's intentions. Now, on a go-forward basis, may we communicate everything through Kevin?
Yeah, do everything through Kevin, and Kevin can send it to us.
As needed. You would be copied on the letter, but, mm-hmm. you know, just for any communications, scheduling and all of mm-hmm. that. If Kevin and I, you know, could work together, that would be great. When the TIF team is established, after you receive the TIF proposal, which will come next week, what the company would be very open to having some of those TIF meeting members come over and tour the facility to see, you know, exactly what's happening, what it looks like, you know, some of the proposed renovations. I think that would, you know, be very helpful. So we'll extend that to you as well.
Would that be something the board could do just to save time, so we could have one kind of crowd? Because if that's okay, we could post a meeting for the board, and the tour will be the meeting. But I think it'd be kind of important to have all the participants in this do that tour. Be mm-hmm. very enlightening.
Sure.
And if I could add to that, Kevin, I know Kevin mentioned town council. Is there any way that we council can be paid for? I mean, our council bills are through the roof. And when we have town council,
they're here looking for taxes back.
No, I'm saying, and a lot of times we ask for council to be paid for.
I think in
involvement, is that a proper thing to ask for?
I think in this case, probably the appropriate thing is we'd want to be doing that, because we wouldn't want, you know, to ask. They're going to have their own legal expense, and we're going to have ours. And in this case, we really want ours paid by us, so that there's no potential conflict or anything in terms of who's paying. And in this case, what we're trying to do is produce the long-term effect of save them money. So, you know, we don't want to start off by saying, hey, we're going to forgive you $1 billion in taxes. Would you pay us something? But I understand the intent, and it's
you're
a good
one. You're the one who keeps reminding us about the town council budget, Kevin.
Oh, no, I know. I'll be the first one to say it, Mark.
So just to follow up, so actually just to piggyback on that, in many other communities, typically a TIF team would consist of the town manager, perhaps the assessor, finance director, maybe a member of the finance committee, and a board of selectmen. So that's in some of the other contiguous communities, that is the group that would actually sit down and have a discussion with the TIF. So that's just, I'm just sharing, you know, what's happening in some of the other communities. And then as far as outreach, we also, we work very closely with Representative Barrows, who's been absolutely phenomenal. He's been key working with all of the businesses and getting the word out. You know, it's all about the community outreach and making sure that the residents understand who Invensys is. You know, it's amazing to know what goes on, you know, behind those, all those walls. And it's really such a great success story. And, you know, what is a TIF? Because as you can imagine, you know, that still means, that definition might be thought of a little differently than a financial vehicle. Mm-hmm. So we actually work closely with the Chamber of Commerce, Kara Griffin, who's here tonight, who's the executive director. Mm-hmm. And the chamber, because many of the chamber businesses that are located here in Foxborough, you know, they're residents too, and they're coming out to vote, and you know, they already do business with Invensys, so that becomes a very key. And of course, Ed Tartufo is just a great and valuable resource after all these years. So we do a lot on the community outreach. You know, we have a team of 10. We have our own TIF attorney, CPA, and a resident outreach specialist, and a local assessor, which is very important. Mm-hmm. So you know, we look forward to working with you on all those items. So what is your timeline to establish a TIF team?
Up until today, there wasn't one. I think we can talk about that. I also wanted just to caution the board, and I know this is a very positive discussion. TIF's been around 50 years or so, and throughout the, I think 49 out of the 50 states have it, and there's a reason, and it works very well. There are examples where it doesn't work well, and there's a negative side to it. And if you ask anyone, you know, in Foxborough, you want to do a TIF, and they say, oh, we've never done a TIF before. So it's not mm-hmm. going to be as easy to get people to understand it. I think that there's going to be a hurdle, so I just don't want to underestimate that when we get to town meeting. Mm-hmm. And people said, why would we ever do a TIF? So I think it's because it's never been done before. And people say, oh, Mansfield's done it, and whatever. We're not set up right now to jump into it. So I think it has to happen quickly at this table right now, unfortunately. If we have the confidence that Kevin from that list, I think I'd add one person on it to consider as the advisory committee, someone from there, and then work with Randy to either dwindle it down, look at that list, and I sometimes smaller is better.
I think a member of the advisory committee is a fantastic idea, particularly since our advisory committee's got some great members on it. Mm-hmm. But when I've tried to get those folks to be on committees before,
that's right,
we've been told they can't. And I don't know if
that, yeah, our moderator's here who will point some.
Head.
You cannot. Okay.
You're killing us, Frank. You're killing us. Just one time.
Are you saying, Jim, you want to decide right now what this committee would be?
In order to, if we work from May backwards,
yeah.
Our next meeting is not for 3 weeks from now. The week before that is school vacation. And I'll tell you right now, the February 26th meeting is overflowing, and we might have to have another one anyway. So if we can set something up today and just spend a few minutes and come up with a timeline, I think it's going to be well worth it.
Do you want a member of our board on it? We can't have you come.
You, having done these before, and no criticism intended or implied, but you will sit in judgment, the five of you. And so my recommendation is for board members to not be on the TIF team, because when we put this together, you want to, my suggestion is you want to be looking at this with fresh and objective eyes, not having already gotten into the guts of it and potentially have become biased due to the process that you were a participant in, as opposed to looking at it objectively. So I think it's more of a staff function, which we then present you with a report. But that's just my suggestion.
How does the board feel about a board member being part of it? Roundabout.
Well, my question was, can as you know, we think about this TIF in the next few days, could we submit questions to the committee? You know, and that would be through you, or would it be through Randy, or
send emails? That's the most efficient way to do it. And then as things go along, you think about it more. Just send more emails and we'll get those into the discussion process.
If we don't have a member of the Board of Selectmen on the committee, would it be proper to have the meetings open so that a member could attend and just
These are monitor? Not open meetings. Absolutely not. And I'm sure they'll tell you these cannot be open meetings.
Yeah. It's negotiations. Correct.
We're going to get into a lot of details about this company that they don't want public.
I don't mean open to everybody in town, but I mean,
and if you wanted to sit in on
to sit in on a meeting, would that be proper, or would that
it's up to you? But again,
there's
five of you,
and it goes to three.
Right, the five of you are going to sit in judgment when this report is given to you.
Well, it's just the questions out there. Does the board feel a board member should be on this committee? I think that's the first thing we should answer. I got a no from Lorraine. I'm looking at her nod. Ginny?
Well, has Mansfield had, did they have selectmen when they had
that? I think there was one selectman that was an advisory member. I can recall when they first started the process, I think it was the town of Dartmouth. They might have had a three-member committee. The chairman of the assessors ruled the roost, if I remember correctly. And so they did it very quickly and very efficiently. But they were numbers people. Your assessment comes into play, so that's why there was someone from the assessors that was responsible for that. I think they did something like 19 TIFs in that town.
Yeah.
And you know, it's they opened the door to get the companies in there.
Yep.
And once they got there, they shut it down and didn't do it anymore. The one advantage of doing those TIFs is they have a maturity date. And when they mature, now you've got some new growth in taxes.
Mm.
So they come back to roost.
That was one of my questions.
When that mature time, yeah. And it's up to the negotiating committee as to how long of a time or tenure you're going to give them. Are you going to give them the minimum? Are you going to give this a 20-year TIF? I think it's 13. Is that the minimum now, Lynn?
20.
13 years or something?
Yeah, now it's 20. Yeah.
So a minimum, you could give them a minimum with 1% TIF or something. Yeah. But that's up to your committee to have negotiations with them, and there are negotiations, and your town manager was right. You really don't want bringing a whole bunch of people in knowing what those numbers are until they can vet that out and come to a conclusion and recommendation back to you people. It's up to you as to how you want to decide your membership. Yeah. But
I mean,
suggestion
just
is let your town manager come up with some suggestions. He can report back to you, or you can have some dialogue, as he suggested, through emails.
Well, we don't want to do that.
Small.
Yeah. We don't want to dialogue through emails, fortunately. I think Jimmy's right. We need to decide on this tonight. Mm-hmm. I mean, let's be proactive here. The one thing which still stands, I mean, we agree Kevin's going to be part of this.
Right.
If we look at it, I'm looking at eyes here. Randy Collins is obviously going to be part of this. Hanya is going to be part of this. And someone from the chief assessors, Kevin?
Yep.
And Sharon?
Sharon. Yeah. Absolutely. So you got five.
No, chief assessor would be Hanya.
I mean, Randy's raising his hand. Randy, I think we better come up to the mic because people at home might be losing us a little bit if you got something to say.
I was saying what Jim just said was Hanya is the chief assessor.
Yeah. Okay, so there's four.
Yeah.
So you got town manager, town planner, CFO.
An assessor.
A chief assessor.
That's it.
And council? No.
And council, but he's not a committee member.
Council is an advisor to the committee.
Yeah. So we got four. You kind of need five because you got to keep an off on the uneven balance because you don't want to have to go a 2-2 or something like that. So
well, they're not voting on anything, right?
No.
So
no.
Just I mean,
they don't.
It's not going to come down to a vote.
Right,
if it gets to that, we've already
it's
failed.
Just a team.
I think it's
going
to come down to a consensus.
A
we're going to work.
Yeah. To put in a little perspective, if you're looking, there's so many different TIFs. If you're looking at a speculative TIF where you're cleaning up the property and bringing in new developments and see what it's going to do to the area, I think you need expertise from you know, maybe the Selectmen or planning and water and sewer and all that stuff, but where it's an existing business, you know what you have, it's only going to get better. I think less is better. I think it's going to come down to Randy's work and the assessors and saying, all right, here's a business, they own one of the three buildings, this is what they're paying in taxes, this is what the brick and mortar are worth if they put in $30 million, this is the spreadsheet, plus these are the meals tax, plus things like that. But I think if we complicate it too much, trying to get from here to May, we're gonna frustrate ourselves.
Just to allay the board's fears a little bit, there aren't a lot of moving pieces to a TIF. It's a fairly simple concept. They're going to come in with some very clear proposals, very clear. And there just aren't, you know, the term, you know, if there's going to be some pilot money in addition to this somehow, I mean, those are the things you're going to be talking about. There are not a lot of moving parts. And it's going to move very fast, you know, once we sit down and start talking.
Okay.
No need to have the building commissioner?
I'm satisfied.
Well, I think we could have Bill as a
assistant,
as a resource to bring him in when we need him, yeah. But I think that four-person committee is going to let us move very quickly.
Mm-hmm. Everyone okay?
Yep.
All right. We have any more discussion?
Well, the Let's only thing formal we haven't answered is there going to be a selectman on four times? So no.
Well, okay. As long as we can, because what Ed brought up was one of the questions I was formulating in my head. As long as we can, you know, send in questions, you know.
Yeah, the dialogue can certainly go back and forth.
You can absolutely do that. And don't forget, this comes to you.
Right.
And when it comes to you, it's not like it's presented and it's yes or no 5 minutes from now. This is your baby when we bring it to you. We're just giving you a report.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you will be the final decision makers to decide whether to send it to town meeting or not.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll have lots of opportunity to get into, you know, questions and whatnot also.
Do we need a motion, Jim, on this?
Well, we don't have an application yet. And I don't think that's required from the state to have a formal motion. But I think what you're hearing is you come with an application. Those are the four people you're going to be dealing with. Whether you like it or not, that's him, and we'll come back to us. And I think it's all, you know, there's a lot of work to do before May. And I know you're swamped with the warrant articles and stuff, so just be as efficient as you
this
can.
This is obviously this is an intensive effort. This isn't like one or two meetings. This is going to take some time.
Yeah.
We're going to have to hit it real hard for a period of time. And that means changing priorities. No, not a problem. This is a very big deal for the town, so.
Sure.
One last question on your warrant for the town meeting.
Yeah.
When does that close, approximately?
We've got it
9 days from now.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that's by bylaw. Mm-hmm. However, this board has the right under the statute to put any article in you want. It's your warrant, remember. It's the warrant of the Board of Selectmen. So, now, there's a practical deadline that we deal with around the 1st of March, because by then, we've got to be giving the AdCom a warrant, because they've wrapped up the budget, and you know, they've got to start dealing with the warrant. We also have the practical problem, we've got to get that thing to a printer. Now, that doesn't happen until a little bit later. So the 14th or 15th of February is the deadline for departments, citizen petitions, et cetera. And we've tried to make that pretty hard and fast. But your deadline is after that.
Do you have to have the actual wording of completed? Or is it just a placeholder?
You can put a placeholder in there.
Yeah. For now, we're fine just with, you know, knowing there's going to be an article.
Yeah.
By around the first week of March, we'll have to have it done. But I don't.
Yeah.
That's not a problem. These are pretty generic. You know, tailor it up a little bit, but not a big deal.
Steve, just one question. You own one of the buildings that's in the two other two you lease. Okay. Your landlord, the owner of the property?
Yes.
Will he be, obviously he's got to buy into this, but he's not at the table. You've discussed it with them?
Of the Cohasset building, you mean?
Mm.
Correct. They're familiar with the discussions that we're having and our intention to apply for the TIF.
Okay. It wouldn't really, it's basically they're not going to not pay the real estate taxes presently valued at. They're going to continue to pay that. It's just based on the $30 million and updates is what I heard. Is that
correct? It would be on the new taxes, right?
Okay.
And
so nothing goes down?
Oh, no. Everything would only go up in taxes, for, you know, tax revenue coming into the town.
That would be something I'd be very eager to hear for is hopefully it's going to expand in employment, because mm-hmm. that's always a decisive thing when it comes to this, you know.
Right. Well, this, you know, as we explained, this would be a job retention project to try to keep 1,000 jobs, you know, here in the town of Foxborough.
You know, my phone will be ringing off the hook tomorrow. Thank you.
Do you have, like, information on explaining what the TIF is that maybe could be emailed to all of us?
Sure.
Because I'm sure we're going to be getting something. It'd be nice to get yes. a little idea of what it
yes,
is.
Actually,
and then we can formulate our own questions.
Sure. We actually have a PowerPoint. It's like an 8-page, if that works for you. Yep. And that's what we usually present to cities and towns, ETAs in Massachusetts, so we can send that.
Okay.
If you want more info, it's like endless.
Google.
Oh, yeah, Google it.
Google
yeah.
Massachusetts TIF. And
yeah. it's
but it's
on
nice
the state
to have it, nice. You know, sent to us.
Yeah, that PowerPoint sounds like it'll be great, because
okay,
it's probably a streamlined
right
version.
Yes.
Okay. That's great.
Okay.
We'll resend it to the board.
Okay. Was there a motion? There was no motion. We're not going to vote on it. So.
And just one last thing, Jim. Should we make a motion just in case, for some reason, the statute says we have to and we don't have to wait 3 weeks to do it to get this initiated, if that's the flavor of the board? Just make a simple motion that these people are going to be on the TIFs committee once they, you know, submit the application. That way, because sometimes we say, well, we don't need a motion. Then we come back and Kevin says, yeah, we need a motion because of this. Unless anybody's here, sure, we don't need a motion to put this TIFs committee.
You don't, but on the other hand, there's nothing wrong with me. I mean, you pretty much agree with the membership.
I'm just
so
giving
you
insurance here. Randy's got his hand up.
Now it's that would make it an official subcommittee of the board, and then the meetings would be public.
Okay, you're a good point, Randy. Okay.
So it's Kevin has it handled, right?
Yeah, let's not do that.
Kevin's got it handled.
I don't know. It's another one of those open meeting law questions. You know.
Thank you.
We'll have to wait 2 weeks to get a legal opinion. Yeah.
You know, once you establish a committee, that doesn't mean you disband the committee.
Sure.
Ready, willing, and able to act in the future. So, and I've said this about Tiff before, once she knows where you live, she's going to come back here.
With
other companies.
We've met before.
Which is great if she can bring other companies to Foxborough. But once you've got that committee established, you know, you convene it as needed. So if there's something else that comes down the pipe next year, 2 years, 5 years from now, you've got your committee established. You know, and whether you take a vote, you don't have to vote on who your membership is, but as Mark wants to do, you want to establish a committee. So you could always take a vote to establish it and then figure out your membership.
Well, we'll just leave it alone, but thank you.
But that's a good point, because what you're going to hear is if you do it for one, you're going to have to do it for the other. So that should be part of your discussions when you're dealing with the assessor.
The floodgate.
Steve, anything else to add before? Because we'll just drag this on all night.
I'd just like to thank the board and Kevin for your time and for the consideration. We'll look forward to working with you.
Yeah, and appreciate you guys being proactive and bringing it to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I mean, do you have any cards for the board in case they want?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next on the item, we had talked about a Saturday annual town meeting, and just for a little history, it was brought up a few times over the last couple of years, mostly from the senior population's benefit, that the meetings go late, and can we consider doing it on a Saturday? We've kicked it around a little bit. We've allowed ourselves to have enough time that if people wanted to do it on a Saturday or didn't want to do it on a Saturday, they were going to reach out. So open up for discussion.
I've heard nothing more about it, Mr. Chairman. I've asked, kicked, knocked on doors, and nobody's, other than the first conversation I had in my last election, I haven't heard a thing about it.
Okay. Lorraine?
I haven't received any requests for it. I have received a couple of objections to it for a religious basis.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As well, yep.
That's true.
Yep.
Anything? All right. Quick, I heard and feel the same thing. So the only quirky thing that we might want to consider is it starts at 7:30. Is there a benefit to move it to 7 o'clock? That way it's a little earlier for the seniors, a little more rush to get there. Any interest in that? If so, the process would be we'd have to change the bylaw, so it's not a quick thing. But does it any interest in changing it from 7:30 to 7?
We have enough problems with people thinking that the election's on Tuesday in this town. If we move the 7:30 to 7, we won't have a quorum to 7:30. because the elections are on a Monday.
I just think a half an hour isn't going to make any difference to anybody, so I think just keep it at the 7:30.
Okay, so the topic is officially dead.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Thank you.
8:15, we had the town manager fiscal year 14 budget.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, this has been a long and stressful night. So what I'm going to do, put me on the clock, I'm going to take you through this in under 5 minutes. Now, I may make it by 1 second, but I'm going to take you through it in under 5 minutes. Because the memo was written, and I know you've had a chance to read it. I can give it to Frank, wherever he went. He's gone. But I'll get it to him later. So here it is. Back in December, we produced a budget for you. We get all the department requests in. It was about $800,000 or something like that. Over budget. So we took all the requests, compared it to revenue. It was way too high. So did about $750,000 in cuts in order to get it balanced. Notably, the school department came in $220,000 under their share of the allocation from the original revenue expense forecast that Randy did for us all back in November. Kudos to the school department. So we got the budget in December, the one that's in your big, thick budget books, positively balanced by about $76,000. That was a lot of work. I won't go through that, but that was all the work that the department heads, Randy and I, do in the month of December to get that budget in. Then we go through it on a second level, and now it's a lot more detailed. And I made a number of additional reductions. So, eliminated a new labor position. I know we can probably use some help in DPW, but I want to see how the DPW concept unfolds before we start adding staff.
Eliminating a position or eliminating a proposed?
No, this was a position which was budgeted new, and I took it out. Okay?
Budgeted new for the fiscal year 14.
Yes. DPW, I removed $50,000. What we used to do when all we had for road maintenance was the Chapter 90 state money, very inadequate. So we put some money in the budget to augment that. Now what we've done with the meals tax money being committed by board policy, we've got a much, almost double the original road budget. So frankly, continuing all this funding in the operating budget is really just too much. I mean, there's a practical limits on how much they can spend. I've taken a small amount out, not anywhere near what the meals tax offset to this is, but some of this can come out in my opinion. And again, this is all feeding into surplus, so it's not going anywhere. It's all available to do whatever, you know, wants to be done with it.
Does anyone mind if we ask questions?
Yeah.
You'll blow my 5 minutes as long as I understand.
That's okay. This is, when we went through the meals tax discussion, it was roadway repair and the OPEB paying off the future OPEB requirements that we have or obligations that we have. What also was clear was we were not going to reduce the budget and then supplement it with the meals tax. In other words, you know, borrowing from Peter to pay Paul. It looks like you're taking this money out of the budget and saying, well, we've done it this way in the past. We're taking this out, putting the meals tax in, and this $50,000 is going to go someplace else. In other words, you're using the meals tax for someplace else, and that is going to stick out like a sore thumb when it gets to the advisory.
Well, where committee. The $50,000 is going is into another surplus. And as you'll see at the end, all these moves create a surplus.
But unless that money goes to the surplus for roads or retirement, it's going someplace where it shouldn't be going. You're going to see it loud and clear when you get
right,
to the ADCOM, because unless I'm reading that wrong from
you,
all the
you
discussions.
Can, you're 90% correct, but we did talk last year about this in depth, and we said that we would revisit it every year annually just to see if that's the path the board wanted to continue to take. I think that's the way I remember it. So.
Correct. So, I mean, if that's what we want to do is...
With the meals tax.
With the meals tax?
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's, it's
well, then
what comes first, the chicken or the egg.
Right.
Do we just make that a policy that we're going to start spending the meals tax for other stuff?
No,
we spend it for other stuff, then we go backwards and make the policy.
But let's say, per se, there was a long-term obligation like the
OPEB,
right? But with, let's say, some conditions that we have in town right now for payment are affecting those long-term OPEB things. and you could head it off now with some of that money, the long-term obligation would be reduced. You know what I'm saying? There's a possibility that you could be moving some of this around, which would still be for the benefit of OPEB, but in a quicker gain now than later. If I can try not to let any cats out of the bags here by saying, you know, there could be a way of lowering the OPEB costs by using the money for other reasons, some of it, that would give you significant cost savings later down the road, which basically would be a direct effect to OPEB by using the money. Is that kind of clear?
Kind of clear.
If the board is of a mind, or the AdCom for that matter is of a mind, to preserve this $50,000, put it back in, you will certainly not get an argument from me. It's just a matter of policy. How big do you want your annual road repair budget to be? It's now going to be pretty close to $1 million. So with $50,000 out, it might be $1,050,000, it might be $950,000. I'm not sure where it will settle, because OPEB is still, it's always a projection forward. But you pretty much have $1 million budget. You used to have $500,000 budget 2 years ago. So do you want to keep all that in the operating budget, all the, you know, half of the meals tax and whatever the state gives us? Because your road budget is growing exponentially, which is fine if that's what you want.
It's needed in a lot of places, but the thing is, I don't want to see road infrastructure worked on that might have a being dug up for a water sewer expansion situation. So that's something that needs to be, if you have to put in escrow just for road for the future, that's fine. But I don't want to be paving roads we're going to be digging up in a year and a half or less time. So that's up to the DPW coordinator.
Well, that's, at the end of this, what I've recommended with this surplus I'm creating is that it all go into capital stabilization. So whether you take it back out for roads or you take it out for other capital, because we have a funding plan for OPEB, we have a funding plan for pension, unfunded pension liability, we have no plan for capital, and we are chronically short every year. We're not funding buildings, vehicles, and all our other maintenance needs, particularly building maintenance. We're not funding it anywhere near what we should be doing, and so we really need a shift into that area.
I'm not disagreeing. You know, it may be warranted, but you know, if we're going to say this is our policy and we're going to change it every year if we need to, then we need to change that policy before we start taking money out and putting it in, sure, anticipating a future policy change. You know, and I remember last year there was a difference of opinion that, mm-hmm, you know, it was for OPEB, it was for road, and it was for capital projects, and that thing got kicked around, and what we decided was only for the two.
So the good thing here is when you have your budget discussion, if you want to put that back in, you know, what you're dealing with is you don't have to cut somewhere in order to restore that funding. It's just surplus will be here or surplus will be here if you want to put it in. Easy decision.
So
you will find me very, very supportive whichever way you go on it, because it's basically all going the same place at the end of the day, road repair or some other capital need.
So the $50,000 is going into a one-time spend. It's not being plowed into the operations budget.
It's not going into the operating budget, no. fire department, there was a $50,000, basically that budget went up $75,000. $20,000 was expenses, $70,000 was overtime. I'm not convinced yet that we've done all the things that we can do to manage overtime, because that's we just finished that in the spring. And so until we've got all those things in place, I really am not prepared to say that we need a $50,000 increase in overtime. So I cut it in half.
Mm-hmm. Just a couple things on this. You know, I went back and looked at the meeting where we talked about this, and the statement that we reiterated the commitment to the policy of a minimum staffing, we had great discussion about it, but basically my opinion is that we were leaving it up to the chief to establish whatever the staffing was going to be, fully recognizing his opinion, but we weren't saying that it's black and white, there will always be six people there. So I just wanted to clarify that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel that we committed to a policy on that.
Okay.
Was one thing.
Well, if you, just so the board knows, if you defer it to him, his policy is six, so that,
correct,
you'll know. Okay.
Yep. But I think a point is if we're saying it's six and he wants seven, he can't do seven because we're saying six.
Oh, okay. So,
right?
I got you.
Right. Or five or whatever. Okay. Either way. So that was just one thing. But the other thing is, you know, we had talked at that meeting about certain things going into effect, and I know we've had some discussions that there some things still need to go into effect. So rather than increase it by any dollar amount, shouldn't we see what the changes are, you know, what the effect is when these changes are implemented? Because if they haven't been implemented, I don't know why we would do anything at this point to adjust this budget. So I'd suggest removing the full 50 out of it.
Here's what I can tell you with a fair degree of assurance. Based upon the actual number of average events from the last 3 years that drive overtime, this budget has been chronically overspent. I mean, every year we've put more in. The three-year average is approximately $100,000 higher than what's currently budgeted. So I've put 25 of that 100 in here. I've left it 75 shy of what straight averages say for the last 3 years. The difference is my wanting to see exactly what you were just talking about. I'm absolutely convinced you need at least 25 in there. Do you need 100? I don't think so, but it's somewhere between 25 and 100. I can't tell you where yet, but I'm very confident 25 is needed.
I agree with you, but I'm just saying from a management standpoint, I'd rather not have any like relief of that pressure, that downward pressure with the number, you know? Like, I'm gonna move the line up 25,000, so it's not, you know, it's 25,000 less difficult to me. I think still expecting that there be good management and, you know, the recommendations that were made,
no, you know, hurricanes that, and no snowstorms.
Well, that's besides the point.
Hopefully. But, you know, that's a big part of it.
The only cautionary note I can tell you is that even with all the management in the world, purposefully underfunding the budget makes no sense to me because we're just going to have to come up with the dough at the end of next year, guaranteed.
And you don't want somebody else to grab it.
Well, it comes out of surplus. It comes out of other budgets that don't expend their full budget or out of the reserve fund. It's either reserve fund transfer or town manager transfer. But at the end of the year, I can pretty well guarantee you that that overtime budget is not significant, is not sufficient, given the six officer minimum staff, which is the chief standard, and he's not going to deviate from it. So I can tell you that budget will be short unless a miracle happens. We are meeting once a month, Randy, the chief, myself, and the personnel director. And there's plenty of pressure, believe me, plenty of pressure. But not everything is implemented yet. And until it is implemented, I can't identify exactly what more we need. The study says 100,000. I don't think it's that much. I think it's less than that. But by the same token, I will tell you, we've had relatively little IOD this year. We have no soldiers away. And those are two huge drivers in the past, and we're still right on the button where we're supposed to be at mid-year in terms of expended year-to-date.
But so, I think perhaps that's because the changes haven't been implemented, and that's what I'm saying is...
No, a lot of it has been implemented, but not as thoroughly as I want. Sick leave analysis has not been done yet, and I'm hoping that there's some... But even if I look at sick leave, I look at the entire chunk, year-to-date, a little over 50 grand... if I assume we can improve that 50%, it's still only 25,000. The dollars aren't there to make the improvements to live with the budget that's in there when we know the three-year running average is 100 more than what's in the budget. It's not going to balance. I can guarantee you that. So,
I understand that. I'm just saying that, you know, from a review standpoint. Again, I'm repeating myself, I guess. I just think that there shouldn't be a change until we know that all of the changes that were recommended to improve the situation have been implemented so that you can actually see what the impact will be. You've got your regular salary budget that, you know, most years is on target.
Unless we have a vacancy. Unless we have a vacancy that stays unfilled for a while for whatever reason.
But, I mean, that's the, in the overtime budget, whatever is made up for that difference, again, I think you're fully staffed now.
Yes.
And some changes have been put in place. Things like, you know, the comp time still need to be addressed, and the sick time, those are pretty significant. I just, I don't think it's wise to increase it, that's all. I wouldn't, from a management standpoint, really, to the manager of that area.
Okay.
All right.
Recreation, we have a long-term goal of trying to make that department self-supporting through fees. They are doing a phenomenal job and have brought in significantly more, such that we can increase them about 20. Now, that's not a big number, but it's moving in the right direction. So, small victory there, and kudos to the rec department. COA Human Services had a $20,000 request in for carpet. We've been able to do some efficiencies. We can cut that to 10. Actual pension assessment came in, and it came in $21,000 lower than we had predicted. Landfill engineering, we have a surplus in that enterprise fund from when we were in the business of solid waste collection. We've got to bleed that money out. So what I'm going to do is use some of it to support the DPW engineer's salary. Now they'll only be able to do that for a couple of years, and then that surplus will be gone, and we'll fold this back into the budget. You can only expend it on expenses related to solid waste, and right now, about the only thing we've got is him. So
can you explain the part of the contract for the solar contract in 14?
Yeah.
you already banking on that?
When the solar company takes, they actually take title, lease title, to the landfill. And they, because they physically own by lease title, not by fee simple, but by lease right, the landfill, they prefer to do the engineering. Because it's now a liability to them, right? It's the flares and the groundwater analysis and all that. So that's $30,000 that we currently pay that we won't have to pay. They take that over.
Okay. But this is for the 2014 budget. Is that that contract's not signed yet? Is it?
No, that doesn't start until July 1,
2013.
This is the fiscal 14 budget, July 1, 2013.
Okay, so the contract will be signed in 2013. And you see the benefits in 14.
Yep. Yep. Sewer Enterprise, we're just tweaking, taking a little bit more of the director's time out of Sewer Enterprise, so it's a third of his time. He's probably spending a lot more than that on sewer issues these days, but suffice to say, we think that's a fair offload. School Department had requested a new technology integration specialist, spent some time reviewing that with them, and I certainly would support it and hope the board would, so I folded it into this budget so that you would get a net picture of where it all is. With these changes made, those changes total $134,000. The recommended budget is now $210,000 below available revenue. A couple of highlights, things that we don't know yet. Local aid, and it's great that Jay is sitting here. The governor's proposal, which is based on new taxes, would give us $317,000. I don't know about you, but I think we all agree the likelihood of new taxes is not great. So how much are we going to pick up? We don't know, but we're forecasting zero, nothing. I think when the dust all settles, we will probably pick something up, but we're not going to try to predict it. Fire department fee increase. I gave you a memo. It's on your desk earlier tonight. I have withdrawn the request for a fire alarm fee. That's a significant piece of this proposal. It is clear that there is a great deal of information which we have to put together. There were commitments made to the business community. I've seen the letters. I can't tell you cleanly as sitting here tonight that it's fair to impose that fee. There are other equity issues too. All I can tell you is a tremendous amount of work that would have to be done for me to know that I'm making a proper proposal to you. That can't happen right now. It's going to have to wait. I also took careful note of the fact that you didn't exactly stand up and cheer at this proposal. Being the shrewd observer that I am, I'm sure that the board was not going to complain at the removal of that proposal, so it was a pretty logical thing to take that away. So that dough is not going to be in here. I wrote this before that, so you can just delete. Liquor license fees, that's still pending. It's not going to come back to you for a while, but I think when I do get it back to you, based on the analysis we did, I know Ginny did some, and thank you. I told you I couldn't get it done. Well, the next day we had an intern start, and the poor young lady had barely sat in the seat, and I said, I got a job for you. So she took the time to do the survey, and we found a very interesting proposal in Mansfield. The way they do it is they have their fee based on the size of the seats in the restaurant. I think that is so enlightened and so smart. And I want to look at that and maybe bring something back to you later, but that's not going to be for a while. So don't, this income is not in play right now. Employee health insurance, we're waiting for rates. I'm not going to get in all that. You know what we're doing. But there's a lot of exciting stuff happening in the area of employee health insurance. When the dust settles, it could go up a little, it could go down a little, it could go down a lot. I don't think it's going up a lot, but I think it might go down a lot. So, you know, we'll be watching that one in terms of what finally happens. Landfill solar, we're negotiating with the vendors. I don't know if, I'm pretty confident that they'll begin construction next year. That doesn't mean we'll get any revenue next year. We may not get it to the following year. So we're not projecting any revenue. But when this does happen, this will be a very, very large new revenue source. So by not predicting it, it'll be available for fiscal 15, and that'll be some great news. Last thing, I'm recommending that we take the $210,000 that we're currently surplus, as well as any other surplus that emerges by all these numbers moving. And we've done this very conservatively. That's the way Randy and I think. I'm pretty sure that more surplus will emerge, and when and if it does, my recommendation is that all go into capital reserve. I'd like to get that capital reserve fund built. So good news, it's $210,000 surplus right now when compared to revenue, but that's a, when we say surplus, what we mean is just that the budget compared to revenue, the budget is smaller than the available projected revenue, but then you turn right around and you say, well, where are we going to use that? Because you know, you've got all sorts of unfunded needs, and capital is certainly one of them. So that's my recommendation, pending the board's review and your decision, you know, what you'd like to do.
Can I just make a comment? I attended the ADCOM budget sessions, and one of the things that was spoken about at the ADCOM was an issue in the personnel wage bylaw. And I think it's nothing we can handle. It's got to go through now because it's in the personal wage bylaw. But I think that should be tightened up. And I would like to see a warrant article for the May town meeting to tighten up things in that. And I just don't know what's the process for doing the warrant article. Who will write it? You know, I'll give the input and explain my concerns, and but I'd like to see a warrant article to address those concerns this year.
The mechanism would be for the board to have a discussion, and then you folks decide what it is you want to do. I'm preparing, if we get it done, some amendments to the wage personnel bylaw to make the wage and personnel bylaw consistent with the Manager Act, because right now you've got several inconsistencies. And they've caused a great deal of confusion, including almost a lawsuit. So we've got to get those fixed so that the documents are consistent. That I'm hoping to have ready and packaged and in front of you in later this month. We just don't have time to look at anything else in there. So if there's a particular topic that the board wants addressed, you need to tell me, and we'll get it ready for you. But I need to know what it is, and I need to know generally what it is you've got in mind. Just sort of consensus, mm-hmm. And then I'll get it written up for you.
No, because I would like to see this presented at the May town meeting.
That is up to you folks, just so it's clear. You've got to tell me.
Yeah.
So,
and
I know you're saying it's the personal wage board issue or topic, but you're not being specific on what it is. So is it, you're talking about the reimbursement?
Right. I think that should be tightened up. So that would be the warrant article, tightening it up.
Eliminating it? When you say tightening up,
Well, would you want me to go into detail right now?
Probably not. Is it on the agenda?
It's not on the agenda.
It's a little sketchy there. I think it has to be put on a future agenda, but if it's a very much concern with you, Jeannie, I mean, definitely put it as a placeholder. You did that right.
Kevin, the 26th, we had warrant articles on that night, right?
Yes.
So if we put this on the 26th...
Are you available on the 19th? Because I was going to ask you for a special meeting on the 19th.
That's vacation with kids.
That's Tuesday night after the holiday. Let me tell you quickly why. We got our new sports pub down there. And they had a little bit of a problem that it brought to my attention today. They filed their liquor license with a floor plan that basically was what was there before. And then, of course, they built what they're building. And they didn't realize that the floor plan that you approve is what's actually legally approved. So here they have, and so I went down there today, and my hope was that they had small differences. It's like gigantically different. So they can't legally open until you review their petition for a change of premises and approve them in, deny, whatever. The fastest we can make that work, because unfortunately it requires a public hearing. So they're doing the paperwork, they're gonna bring it in tomorrow, we're gonna get it right in the paper. The fastest I can make it work for them is the 19th. Literally it's actually the day before the holiday, but we can't meet on a holiday. So the first day you can meet is the 19th. You could theoretically approve it that night, they can open the next day. If not, then they're gonna have to wait another week until the 26th. The other problem is, your agenda on the 26th is really full. So trying to add bylaws and other things, I mean, you can't do it on the 26th. You've got a tremendous amount of business already booked.
And we're already coming in early that day, correct? 26th?
Yeah, well, we were going to come in an hour early to go to the common to see the lighting of the
common
light. Kevin, if we put it in Thursday's paper, that's the 7th, it's going to be advertised for 10 days, that's a 21st.
Yeah, we've already done the math. You can make the 19th.
You're counting Saturday and Sunday as a day?
You can count them, yes.
I see, okay.
I can make the 19th. I'm probably the only one, but I can.
Now, my suggestion is if you can't all make that night, meet for 15 minutes and go over this floor plan and vote it, because, you know, I don't think it's a big policy level decision. It's basically they've done what they told you they were going to do. Unfortunately, the floor plan they filed was not what they built, because they didn't realize.
You can give them a temporary liquor
license. No,
you can't do it. Yeah, already tried.
We were going to give them today.
We were going
to
get them a whole series of 1 days, but you can't have a 1 day.
Correct.
Yeah.
So
let me suggest this: where it's better than looking at a plan. Take a drive out there, look at the restaurant, because it's built, it's shiny clean, and you can see exactly what it is. Look at the old plan, and it's the chairs are different and the bar is different. Set it up for the 19th, if we can get three people here. I can't, I've recused myself because my client is the landowner, not Jake and Joe's.
I can't be here.
I can't be there.
So. I can be here.
Can you be here, Mark?
No, I'll be here.
Yeah. All right, so the three of us.
Yeah. Well, my suggestion, and it's not a full board, you just deal with that and any other emergency things that night that are non-substantive, and don't deal with any policy level stuff, because
I understand.
Okay.
All right. And all right, so it's the end of the discussion since it's not on the agenda.
Yeah.
So getting back to your warrant article question, Kevin, on the 26th, can we add that to the list?
Sure.
It's not a new agenda item. It's already on there, right?
I'm gonna get cots for you guys and food and blankets. And
Randy?
I was just going to suggest, I think I'm aware of the modification that Selectman Coppola is thinking of proposing. We already have the standing article. It's Article 6, the personal wage article. So it's just a modification to language on an article that you're already considering. Okay. So when you consider Article 6, you consider the language.
Yeah, it's okay. It's not a big deal writing it. I can write that in 10 minutes, literally. I just need to know what you want to do.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, I can write it up, and then I'll send it to you and to.
But then you guys have to vote it.
Well, we'll vote it
on the 26th.
You send it to Kevin.
Okay.
Put it in the language in whatever Randy already has in there with you, and then we'll look at it and make the comments at that time with everything else.
Great.
Action, baby.
So, Kevin, that's it for the budget.
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I know you tried to do it in 5 minutes, but I know there's a ton of work that goes into that.
Thanks, department heads and Randy.
They all did a great job.
Yep. Not to keep going back to it, but last year we had the $400,000 surplus. We voted to,
You reduced the
with the advisory committee.
Tax exempt library bond.
Was that a one-time bond?
Yes.
We don't have the ability to
do
that
again. Well, the
reduction
is a one-time, yes. You've issued the permanent debt, right?
Yes.
So you can't do that. There's
no other bonds around that we could put that against.
No other exempt bonds.
Exempt bonds.
One of the things we discussed doing with in the next year, meaning the year that we're approaching, is to put another $150,000 into our stabilization fund, aside from capital stabilization, to get us up to 5%. Okay. We put $250,000 in last year, and what we've discussed is adding another $150,000 okay. this year. So that's my suggestion of where $150,000 of it goes.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
And that, remarkably, is exactly where my suggestion came from. I said, Randy, what do you recommend?
And just last comment on the budget, Ginny and I had lunch with breakfast with some of the selectmen in Mansfield, and I think when we said they asked how we were doing on the budget, we said there's a surplus, and I think every other town is just struggling, and just kudos that, I know there's a lot of work that goes into it, and the businesses and the people participating, but to be in a position where, again, we're talking about not doing layoffs and not going reverse, I don't want to lose sight of that. It's good news.
But it was also an interesting discussion, seeing how we both towns have the same problems, but then we have totally different problems. So it was an interesting discussion.
Okay, now we have to go in. Oh, geez, we got action items. Minutes from the 15th, the 22nd. Any comments on those minutes on the 15th?
I did on page 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the sixth paragraph. Mrs. Coppola asked if the flow will only be used in Foxborough. Mr. Hill stated there is an existing contract for part of Sharon. Could we specify that it was Summerfield is the contract, please?
Summerfield.
Was it Summerfield or Cannon Forge? So
yeah.
It would be Summerfield / Cannon Forge.
Summerfield, I thought, is that way.
Well, Summerfield is the one close to Sharon.
It is.
Summerfield goes from Sharon. It goes from into Sharon to Sharon. Then it goes into Foxborough and into
Cannon Forge
on the other side.
Okay.
But I think where the line is drawn, I'm not sure. But it's a confusing little area. But
I just wanted to make sure it was a yeah, huh? Because I'm pretty sure he said. He said it was
Summerfield. Summerfield, okay.
I mean, do you want to check with, should we check with Roger just to make?
Yeah, I can ask.
Yeah.
So approving conditions of land checking with Roger?
Yeah, can we do that? Thank you. That's all I have.
Okay.
Motion to approve minutes of January 15th, 2013.
Motion made, seconded.
Second.
Motion made by Lorraine, seconded by Mark. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. Minutes of January 22nd.
I have a...
Anybody?
I had a couple of comments on page 6, the town asset review update. 7 paragraphs down, the Garrett Spillane property. I wanted to change the wording a little bit to the Garrett Spillane property was discussed, and Mark Sullivan suggested it have a covenant.
I said, could a covenant be put on the Garrett, the lot on the Garrett's Lane property?
So I just wanted to make it
avoid access to the 20 acres behind it. Too.
Yeah, and I had a it should be Garrett's Lane Road, because
road,
you know, and three-foot paragraphs down, it says Garrett's Lane land, and it should be actually road, Garrett's Lane Road land.
Garrett's Lane Road land. Okay, and then on the second to last paragraph, the Oak Street land was purchased in 1974 after town meeting recommended the purchase and wanted it used for recreational and recreation and conservation purposes. And then I wanted to strike due to clerical error. However, the land was not recorded as recreation and conservation land. This would need to go to town meeting. That stays the same. And then town council is reviewing. I can't read my own writing. Reviewing the format of the vote. Is that what?
Yeah, he was looking at.
Right, and provide recommendations or options that are available. Is that?
It sounds right. Like that. Yeah.
I know there was a question. The town council is reviewing the format of the vote and will provide recommendations.
And on page 2, the third paragraph from the bottom, the hours of the race are 7:45 p.m. to 2:15 a.m. It's during the evening. Yeah, I checked it. I went back and checked the application. Yeah.
Okay. What? A road race?
In the evening.
Where are you saying that?
On look at the application on January 22nd.
So January, so 7:45 p.m., they're going to run till 2 in the morning?
2 a.m. That's what it said on the that's what it said on the application.
It's weird.
At the run to the sea.
2 to 300 runners coming through town between the hours of.
This that one. Doesn't make sense.
Does that make sense?
No. Well, that's what's on the application.
I can ask Chris.
It's in, it's the January 22nd meeting, the application.
I didn't
get the app once I took it. I think in the application would be wrong.
I mean, when they were talking, I thought I got the sense it was the.
I remember that last year. There was.
Check it.
Okay.
So, motion to approve minutes of January 22nd as amended.
I'm sorry. One other question I had on page 5. On the very top, it just has a statement that says, this is about waxies. It says the suspension will be on the record, and if there is another event within the next 2 years, they will be out of business. I don't know what that means. I mean, it's not a point of fact. Did someone say that, or?
I think Kevin said that.
Yeah, Kevin just said it as part of the narrative.
I most assuredly, he gave them a heads up warning. Don't come back, blah, blah, blah.
I guess just attributed to Kevin.
I don't remember you said that.
Okay. So, I just attributed to Kevin. Something that was Kevin said.
Oh, yeah. I could add it. You want me to combine it with?
Yeah, that'd be fine. Okay. Well, so motion was made with that comment. Seconded.
Second.
By Mark. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. We have a request for the hacky license for 2 years, Salah Al-Masawi and Robert Loring. And both were signed by the police and the applicant. And it seems to be in order.
They're
both
new, so moved.
Second.
Motion to approve, seconded by Lammy Linda, seconded by Mark Fault. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. We have a request for a 3-year appointment to a constable. Nathan Green is a renewal, and Paul Terrio is a new applicant. Any comments?
Both of them have been approved by Ed, right?
Mm-hmm. So one's a reappointment, one's a new one.
One's a new, yeah.
Ed, queried them both. No objection.
Okay. You hear a motion?
Motion to renew the constable appointment for Nathaniel Green.
Second.
Motion made, seconded. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. A motion for Paul
Motion
Terrio.
To approve the appointment for 3 years for Paul Terrio.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. No, any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Both motions carry 5-0. Mark Logan over at the Foxborough Regional Charter School has made an application for a 5K and 10K road race on November 2nd from 9 a.m. to 10:30 a.m.
Burr.
2.5 hours.
That's me coming at 2.5.
Yeah, on a good day. Okay, and it was signed by Chief Hatfield. His only
comment is... It's an hour and a half.
I still won't be there for 2.5.
You see Chief Hatfield's comment? Condition? Be safe.
Be safe, yeah. 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 Yeah, it's all good. So moved.
Motion Second. Made to approve, seconded. Further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. And an application for an automatic amusement device license for one video game at Waxy O'Connor.
This is touchy, though. I mean, I'll bring this up. It's been brought up before. It might sound simple. We've had other places in town in the past, including the basketball on Green Street, I should know it by heart, RBI basketball, and the basketball courts, Mass Premier. They wanted to put arcades in there.
Mm-hmm.
And the board I was on back in the day said, no, I don't know if things have changed since then. I know they have some crane machines in there and stuff. I don't know if you call those arcade games. I'm not sure, but slippery slope here is that sometimes then it goes to pool tables and you're getting a little into a zoning issue.
Well, they, I mean, Waxy's has pool tables
okay,
anyway.
Okay, so they already have one of those. I've
this never is, been it there? Just says a Golden Tree Live video
Thank
game.
Goodness.
I don't know what that is.
It's a golf game.
Yeah, it is Golden Tree Live. You're right.
It's yeah, it's so just a, like, video.
Okay. They already have a pool table? Because that's a special license.
Yeah, and they have the license for that. We approve it every year.
I'm not aware of that.
That's funny.
Yeah. I don't get all much.
Come on, Sully.
I spend all my time here.
He still plays Pac-Man. Okay.
So I move to approve the... That's automatic cool. amusement device license for one video game machine at Waxy's.
Second.
Yeah, motion made. Motion made and seconded. Motion made, seconded. In further discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Motion carries 5-0.
Kevin, do we need to go into executive session tonight?
Yes, you do.
Okay.
Sometimes
you say no.
Okay. Sometimes you say no.
Motion to go into executive session to
when you need
discuss.
Oh. Going.
Deep.
DPW.
Negotiation perimeters, and intend to come into back into regular session solely to adjourn.
Motion made. Seconded you.
Second.
All those in favor, Linda?
Yes.
Kenny?
Yes.
Lorraine?
Yes.
Mark?
Yes.
And I say yes, so unanimous. Thank you all, Foxborough. Frank, thank you very much back there.